one of you present on this virtual platform today. Now the world is ruled by the one who has highest amount of data. A huge amount of data is generated every day, and it is growing in four different dimensions called as four V's of data, which are volume, velocity, veracity, and variety. So it is very important to process the data in such a manner that it helps us in finding the conclusions, it helps us in taking the decision. So this process is called as data analytics. And today we are going to learn an open source software, Orange, which is very useful in data analysis and visualization. Friends, this is a collaborative effort of the entire department to organize this particular workshop. Dr. Asha Zindal, Associate Professor and Head of the Department of Statistics, KC College, has supported this idea, and she was instrumental in making this workshop happen. I call upon Dr. Asha Zindal ma'am to deliver the welcome address. Over to you, ma'am.
Thank you, Pratiksha. I take this wonderful opportunity to extend a very warm welcome to Dr. Sangeeta Chaudhary, Dr. Sagarika Damle, coordinator of the DBT Star Status College Scheme, and all my dear participants. On behalf of the Department of Statistics, as head, a teacher, and also a proud alumna of this college. Kishanchand Chelaram College was established in 1954 under the aegis of the Hyderabad Sindh National Collegiate Board. The college has been re-accredited with the A grade by the National Assessment and Accreditation Council in three consecutive years as A grade. The college was adjudged as the best college in urban area by the University of Mumbai in 2015. And the institute has created a benchmark in the field of education. KC College has been awarded many laurels in various fields. In 2019, the college was awarded with Star College Status Scheme by Department of Biotechnology, Government of India. And very recently, yesterday, we have come to know that we were being recognized as the Science Setu 2 by the Department of Biotechnology, Government of India. Today, it has the distinction of being one of the five colleges in Mumbai with the star status awarded by the DBT. The college is also funded with the prestigious FIST program by Department of Science and Technology, Government of India. The college has a various impressive number of companies where the students have been placed post their studies from the graduation to PhD. KC College is recognized as one of the finest colleges in South Mumbai, which lays great emphasis on the holistic development of its students. Keeping abreast with the latest development, demands, and needs of the industry and academia, we have chalked out this interdisciplinary workshop in Orange Software. Orange Software is used in biomedicine, bioinformatics, genomic research, machine learning, and for data mining, data visualization, and data analysis. It is written in Python, Cython, C++, and C languages. As a mentors, we have this great responsibility of fortifying our students, making them capable and honing skills in them so they are successful in whichever career they choose. So hence we have organized this skill-oriented program under the aegis of DBT Star College Status Scheme of the KC College to guide the students and develop skill in them. With these few words, I hand over again to the Pratiksha.
Thank you so much, Asha ma'am. Dr. Sagarika Damle, our DBT Star Status Coordinator, who is Head Associate Professor and Head of Department of Life Sciences, KC College. She is serving in the field of education since last 29 years. She has held various prestigious positions for academic and co-curricular activities. She is a research associate for environmental impact assessment projects by state and central government. Madam is a member of governing body of WCT Research Foundation India, former member of Board of Governors of NITs at NIT Arunachal Pradesh. She is also a member of Managing Committee Devavani Mandiram, a charitable trust engaged in the promotion of Sanskrit language. She is a recipient of Indian National Science Academy INSA Award for the Best Teacher in the year 2019. She has also received the Best Teacher in Life Sciences Award by Trans-Asian Chamber of Commerce and Industry of India in February 2020. And also, she was felicitated by Vigyan Gaurav Puraskar for Excellence in Science by RD and SH National College and SWA Science College in February 2020. We are very fortunate to have such a dynamic DBT Star Status Coordinator who always supports the activities conducted by our department. Now I request Dr. Sagarika ma'am to address the gathering. Over to you, ma'am.
Thank you, Pratiksha madam. Am I audible? Am I yes. audible?
Yes, yeah. ma'am.
Thank you so much for that elaborate but not so necessary introduction. A very, very good morning, Shubha Sakar, to everybody present here. And I extend a very warm and heartfelt welcome to Dr. Sangeeta Chaudhary from Ram Rao Adhik College. I think we are really fortunate to have you with us, madam, today. And yes, a congratulatory note to the entire statistics department for organizing this very, very important workshop, I would say, on open source data visualization or machine learning toolkit, which is Orange. I hope I have not gone wrong anywhere. But I think today the time has come where there are no walls or boundaries between the learning quotients or subjects, you know. So as rightly proposed and supported by our principal ma'am, Hemlata Bagla ma'am, she is a scientist as well, and she promotes whatever possible knowledge should come to all. And DBT Star Status Grant gave us this opportunity to extend this knowledge to not only ourselves, but to extend it across, I would say, colleges or maybe sometimes at national and international level. So DBT Star Grant has definitely given us that boost. But let me tell you, KC College was always on the forefront of organizing newer ideas and collaborating with bigger and better resource people and institutions across the country, even before the University of Mumbai could, you know, implement it. So I think with this new university that we are, HSNC, we are a constituent college of that, I think we are taking this in our stride, and we are marching towards a together, all-inclusive kind of a culture where learning is concerned. I would not take much of your time, but I would just add this that, you know, Department of Statistics, I can say, is one of our star department who is always organizing these useful things. Just I would like to bring it to the attention of, I think, Pratiksha ma'am, as well as Asha ma'am and all teachers in their department, that though she said it is a collaborative effort of all teachers of the department, I think you have a bigger opportunity, Asha ma'am, to collaborate with any other department in the college, say IIT, computer science, biological sciences, mathematics, because statistics is omnipresent. I think you are so fortunate, and your fortune has become doubled because our Honorable VC sir, Panjwani sir, is also from statistics department, or he has a statistical person. So I think what more than we can ask for. So congratulations once again, and I'm looking forward to more interdepartmental or intercollegiate collaborative activities where the stakeholders or the learners number also increases. So once again, congratulations. Big welcome to Sangeeta Chaudhary, ma'am. And ma'am, I would also look forward to some collaborations with your college in near future. And as I was going through this Orin software development, I saw that it was developed at University of Ljubljana in Slovenia. It's a very beautiful country, and I think we can look forward to, having some teacher exchange or teacher collaborations with the Slovenian Ljubljana University. So our dreams are big, and I'm sure all teachers present here and all students who are our dreams, which will connect us with the future world, are here. So welcome everybody once again with those few words. I wish this workshop a great success, and over to you, to the host. Thank you so much.
Thank you so much, Sagarika ma'am. Now I call upon Mr. Suraj Singh, Assistant Professor, Department of Statistics, to give the formal introduction of our today's speaker, Dr. Sangeeta Chaudhary.
Thank you, ma'am. Hello, everyone. I am Suraj Singh from Department of Statistics, KC College, and I take this wonderful opportunity to introduce our today's speaker, Dr. Sangeeta Chaudhary, ma'am. So Dr. Sangeeta Chaudhary, ma'am, is currently working as professor in Computer Engineering Department, Ram Rao Adhik Institute of Technology, Nerul, Navi Mumbai. She has 20 years of teaching and research experience. She has completed her UG and PG, undergraduate and postgraduate, in computer engineering in 1999 and 2008 respectively. She has earned her PhD from IIT Bombay in geospatial data security in 2016. She has published research papers in 10 international journals, 2 book chapters in Springer, 36 international conferences and 29 national conferences in India and abroad. She has received 6 best paper awards for her national and international paper presentation. Dr. Sangeeta Chaudhary, ma'am, has received funding from IEEE, DST, and IIT Bombay to present research paper in international conferences in USA, Canada, and Malaysia. She has published a textbook titled Digital Forensics and Cyber Security and Laws. Ma'am is a senior IEEE senior member, IEEE GRSS, and IEEE WIE member, ISRS Life member, and ISTE Life member. Ma'am is Vice Chairperson of IEEE GRSS Bombay Chapter and Vice Chairperson of IEEE WI Affinity Group Bombay Section. Ma'am is manuscript reviewer of many Indian and international journals. She has been a conference chairperson, session chairperson, and reviewer of many national and international conferences. Dr. Sangeeta Chaudhary, ma'am, has organized technical workshops and activities for undergraduate and postgraduate students and faculties under the umbrella of IEEE GRSS. Dr. Sangeeta Chaudhary, ma'am, has delivered invited talks and conducted workshops in the domain of GIS, image processing, and cybersecurity. Ma'am is approved postgraduate and PhD teacher in Mumbai University and D.Y. Patil deemed to be University, Nerul, Navi Mumbai. Ma'am is an active member of various community at Mumbai University. Dr. Sangeeta Chaudhary, ma'am, has a research interest include digital image processing, information security, advanced databases, geographic information system, and high performance computing. With this brief introduction, I would like to welcome ma'am for this session. Welcome, ma'am. Thank you.
Welcome, Sangeeta, ma'am. Over to you.
Yeah. Thank you, Suraj sir, for the kind introduction, and Asha ma'am and Sagarika ma'am. Correctly, you said that there are many what we can say the applauds at KC College, and I'm very happy to be connected with you all. And let me just share that my first job, I started with HN, this management only, at Institute of Technology, Ullasnagar. So I'm connected to this from many years, and I'm again very happy to be a part of this program and get connected with you all. And definitely we will have some collaboration in coming years so that we can work. And as we are from computer engineering background, so we always need some mathematical foundation, and we are very much fascinated towards the statistics and probability thing, because whole computer science is based on those mathematics only. So of course we will take that thing in mind, and we will have some collaboration in future. So coming to today's session, as ma'am correctly said, ki in today's era, it's a world of data. So data is having a very high value, and if you have seen the big opportunities in industry, so there are big opportunities available to work in the field of data science, machine learning, and artificial intelligence. But now you could have the question in mind that how the people from statistics or how the people from mathematics can actually contribute in this. So you are the people who are actually backbone of all those things. And of course, the whole machine learning, the data science is actually based on statistics and probability. So even though we are from computer science engineering, we actually lag in some of the mathematical concepts, which you people are very good in those. So of course, you can also have a lot many opportunities to come in this area, and you can explore many things. As we are engineer and we are trying to explore many technical aspects, but at the core, the whole phenomenon on which we are actually working is based on mathematics only. So that's why this topic is very much related to the mathematics, that to statistics and probability. So I guess everyone, each one of you will be benefited by seeing what kind of applications which you can actually explore being a statistic scientist, or maybe a graduate of statistics, or maybe a graduate of mathematics. So this is just a little introduction from my side. So coming to the today's workshop, so mainly I'm covering about the software. Okay. And I thought that, see, there are many tools available, okay? And one can explore those tools. There are many programming languages available, which one can actually write a code and do some kind of data analytics. But as you are the people from mathematics, and some of you might be very good in writing programming, but some of you are not so good in writing programming. So I thought I'll take this tool and I'll just give you brief about how you can use or how you can explore the things which are there in statistics and how it can be used in data analytics further. So that was the agenda of the day. And that's why this particular software is chosen for the workshop. And so the workshop will be divided into two parts. In the first part, I'll be giving you a brief introduction about Orange and the little features which are available in Orange, as well as what kind of things which are actually put into the Orange by simply adding some add-ons or by adding some programming capabilities into it. And then we will see some hands-on practice of some algorithms which base is only statistics. So I hope everybody is keen to learn this Orange software. And as I'm going with the hands-on, so that's why yesterday I put the link in the group. So those who have actually installed this software, so they can just start with me parallelly, so that you can get to know what kind of things are there and you can explore many things in future, as well as side by side, you can explore the things. And let me tell you that this software is not at all difficult. Any layman can learn this software because so many things are available here, and just drag and drop facility we can have and we can do that. No need to write some programming over here. Of course, we have a programming feature also. So those who want to explore at much more detailed level, or if you want to do some kind of exploratory analysis and all, then obviously, you can actually integrate the programming with this particular software. Okay? So as I mentioned that we will be seeing Orange software. So let me just give you a few characteristics of Orange software. So since time, there are many software coming up in the market. Some of the softwares are proprietary, some of the softwares are open source. Okay? And if you have heard about the software called as Weka, so since maybe from 90s, this software was available, and so many people were using those software, and they are doing some kind of analysis in the area of data mining. But now, as in today's era, okay, the whole thing is now shifted, or the whole domain is converged to advanced domain, and that we are now giving the name as machine learning or a data science, where we are doing lot many analytics. Like we are doing some image analytics or data analytics or text analytics, and all these things are actually based on statistics only. So Orange is providing you a way to do all such kind of analytics. At the same time, it is providing you a way to do some exploratory analysis and visualization, because visualization is very important. Just if you are showing the numbers or maybe the values of those data, then nobody will understand. But if you can plot it, if you can visualize it in a particular graphical format, in a proper attribute denotation and all, then it will be very easy for people to understand it. So that's why Orange is used for analytics as well as for visualization. And there are many features available in Orange which can be used to do such tasks. Yeah. Along with that, as I mentioned, if you are a layman, if you are very new to this software, you can just use drag and drop facility of this software and you can do the task. Or if you are more interested, or if you are very keen in writing some programming, so this software is providing you a way to write your own code in Python. So if you are comfortable in Python, you can write a code and you can control the way of analytics and the visualization by writing such code snippets, small snippets, which control the visualization. So the power of Orange is limitless. Yeah. Also, one can integrate the various modules which are there in Orange in the programming languages. Okay, so it is not the case that if you want to use Orange, you can just need to install that Orange and use the drag and drop facility. The Orange software, as it is open source, all the snippets, all the functionalities are available. So you can embed those in your programming and you can have your own visualization and analytics. Okay. As I mentioned that mostly this particular software is being used by people for just learning purpose. Okay. But let me tell you that in many industry or in research laboratory, yeah. So I guess I was muted. Yeah. Am I audible now?
Yes, ma'am.
Yeah. So that it is being used in industry as well as in research field, okay, to do lot many research. I'll be showing you some of the case studies where you can see how it can be used for research purpose. And very easily you can do that and you can come up with a publication just by doing a little analysis over there. Okay, so this is all about a little introduction about Orange. I'm not going into the detail about where it was invented and how it was actually processed, but it was invented, I guess, in last decade, and there are many features added. And currently the latest version of this Orange is 3.27 with lot many capabilities and features. And time to time they're releasing the different distributions of it and different versions of it with some additional capabilities and additional features. So yesterday I gave you one link if you have downloaded it and installed it. So currently you are using 3.27 and we are using the latest release of that. Okay, so all the features and all the capabilities are there in those, okay, which are available at today's date. Okay. Let me just mention one more thing about Orange, that I'm mentioning you that I'll be showing you some of the basics as well as some case studies. Okay. But along with that, if you are aware about time series analysis and all those things, so that can also be done. It can be used for educational purpose also. So I'll be showing you that, of course, and then you can get more idea about what Orange can do and what kind of things which you can explore further with the help of Orange. Okay. So let me just share my screen. So can I just get a feedback whether my screen is visible or not?
Yes, it is visible.
Yeah. When you install Orange on your system, okay, when you click on it, the icon, okay, you will be getting the screen like this. Okay. So first, I'll be giving you a brief overview about the features and the different widgets which are available readily in Orange. And then we will see how to use them, okay, one by one. Okay. So those who already installed the Orange software on your system, okay, you can start, you can open the Orange software and you can just explore it along with me so that it will be easier for you to do some experimentation later, okay, using Orange. Okay. So if you can see, Orange screen is divided into two parts. Okay. This blank space, which you are seeing over here, okay, that is called as workspace, okay, where we are actually performing the analysis task. Okay. And if you can see at the left hand side, okay, there are many widgets available. So if you can see over here, the widgets are actually categorized into various sections. So the first section is called as data.
Which are the ingredient ticket packet, ma'am?
Hello? Yeah, so I guess some disturbance was there in between. Okay, so let me continue. So if you can see on the left hand side, okay, you can see various sections. So the first section which you can see over here is the data section. Okay, so mostly this data section is dealing with all the inputs which you are taking from different forms. Okay, and you can actually do some kind of pre-processing over there. Let me tell you one feature which Orange is supporting, that it can take a data, okay, or we can say that it can take a data from heterogeneous sources or in heterogeneous format. So it is not the thing that all the data which you want to process should be in particular format. You can have a data in maybe your Excel file, in a CSV file, or maybe if you're working with some databases, and if you're having a data in that particular database, like if you're using Oracle and so, and you're having the data in SQL, so you can use those data directly over here. If you're working with Microsoft Access, and if you're having the data in tabular format, in tab format, so that also you can use. You can create your own data, okay? You can also have some data which is coming from web also. I'll be showing you some of the examples of that. So if you can see over here, I can have a data in tabular format by clicking the file. I can get the data in from CSV file. I can take the data from various data sets. Okay. And of course, these data sets are online data sets. So it is once you select the data set, it is downloaded and you can use it. So if you are aware of a site where lot many data sets are available related to data science and machine learning, so that site is Kaggle. So Kaggle is a data storage, or we can say it's a website where lot many datas are available and people are using those pre-data and coming up with some models, and they are doing some kind of statistical analysis on those datas. Okay, so such data also you can take. As I mentioned, from Oracle or some SQL, you can take the data. You can have your own table. You can create your own table and you can use those tables. Okay. Also, you can create your own data by painting it. I mean, just you can have a sample and you can paint it and you can use it. Okay. So likewise, you are having so many things. Now, one more thing is that if you are having a large data with millions of records, okay, you are having millions of entries in that data set, and actually you don't want to work on all those millions of records. You are only interested in few, maybe 1,000 records from those data, or maybe that data is having multiple attributes. Like say, for example, take a COVID data. So in COVID data, we are having so many aspects, like we are having some data which is related to medical field. We are having some data which is related to geographical field. Okay, we are having some data related to environmental conditions and all. So all these things are comprising the attributes of that data, like columns. Okay, so if you're not interested in all the columns, then possibly you can cut down them. Okay, and you can take only selected column. So yes, such facility is also available. Okay, so if you can see over here, okay, you can have here select column, select row. So if you want to only take few records from the data, okay, or only few columns from the data, you can use it. If you want to actually merge the data which are coming from different data sources, you can have a merge option also. If you want to concatenate the data, like if you want to append one data up in other data, you can use the concatenation. Okay, you can have concatenation by using the indexing, okay, or by using some key which is assigned to that. Not many features are available. Okay, and if you can see over here, this thing we'll be seeing in a practical, okay, how we can use this. Okay, transpose is a actually it's a function where rows becomes column and column becomes rows. So if you want to change it, you can change it. If you want to randomize the data, okay, you can also use, we know that the data is, in some cases, the data is in discrete value. And in some cases, the data is actually representing, the data is represented in continuous variable format. Okay, so if you want, and sometimes some of the values are missing those data. Okay, so these things can be done with the help of some of the widgets which are readily available over here. And as I was mentioning earlier, this particular widget, that is Python script. So you can combine this Python script with the widgets, and you can control the way in which you want to do the analytics and you want to visualize the things. But for time being, I'm just keeping this aside because it is very heavy to learn, because you one need to know the Python programming language, then only, and they also should know that how every widget is working, what kind of input and output those widgets are taking, then only it will be possible. Okay, so that is one thing. Okay, so this is first section called as data. Okay, now going to the next section, if you can see, there are many sections available over here. Some of the sections may not be available in your software. Okay, because here I'll be telling you why it is so and how to add those in your Orange software. So if you can see now, these four sets, okay, these are very important from the analytics. So if you can see, this next set is visualize. Okay, so if you want to perform some visualization, of course you need some kind of plots. So I guess as you are from statistics department, you are knowing how to represent the data in graphical formats. So most, either we are using a line chart or bar chart or pie chart and so on. Okay, but there are different ways to represent. I guess you might be knowing some other ways also. Okay, so here the facility is provided that you can actually visualize the thing in different ways, and you can actually see some kind of statistical parameters of those data by visualizing it. So it is just not a mere visualization. You can also see some kind of parameters, statistical parameters of those particular data. So I'll be showing you by taking example later on when we'll see the practical. Now come to this model. Okay, so if you can see, okay, this particular model section is a collection of the algorithm, okay, which are used to perform some kind of classification or prediction. Okay, so if you are aware about machine learning, okay, so there are many machine learning algorithms, and of course we know those algorithms are categorized into two forms or two categories: supervised and unsupervised. So of course the supervised means a teacher is available, or some kind of supervised sets are available and with which we can actually train our model. Okay, and in unsupervised there is no such, and you can directly work on the data. So that's why if you can see over here, all these models which you can see over here, okay, they are in supervised category. And similarly, if you want to go in unsupervised, so these are the tools which are present in unsupervised. So I'll be showing you one by one. So don't worry at this time. We'll see what kind of things are there. Okay. And then we'll see how to use it. Okay. Now, evaluate. So no analytics is actually complete until unless you are showing the accuracy at particular analytics. Okay. So here, this particular evaluation box, or we can say evaluation section, will be giving you the wizards which are helping you to actually represent the outcome of your learning, okay, or outcome of your analytics. Okay, so here you can see mostly six widgets are available. We'll be seeing all these six widgets and we'll see in what way these are actually used. Okay, and then coming to next, this one that is image analytics, time series, text table, text mining, and geo. Okay, so these are the widgets which are actually not available when you have installed the Orange software. So you need to install some add-ons, then only you will be getting this particular set of widget. So let me just tell you how to install this. Okay. So if you can go on option, okay, if you can click on option, you can see add-ons over here. Okay. So if you click on add-on, okay, it is showing you the complete list of add-ons which are available in Orange. Okay, so they are not by default available in Orange. You need to install them. So if you can see over here, currently I have installed here Geo. You can see here it is the checkbox. It is checked. Okay, then Image Analytics I have installed over here. Okay, likewise if you can see text table and time series I have installed. So see the sections over here. Okay. So depending on what kind of application you are working, okay, you can install. So if you can see over here, we are having the add-ons for associate. Okay, we are having the add-ons in as the bioinformatics. So there is this bioinformatics field is again a very hot research area in current days, and lot many people are working on genome analysis. And here again, the statistics is making its own footprints to do the analytics part. So people are using this kind of tools, and they are using basic statistical approaches to actually come up with some kind of genome analytics. And it is proving, or it is very much used in a lot many research. So if you know the current COVID pandemic, so mutation which is happening in the virus, okay, all those things are actually monitored by taking the genome of those, and of course the analytics is performed. So you can actually take the data set and you can use some of the widgets which are available in such kind of categories, and you can do the experimentation. Okay, like if you want to use for educational purpose, then we are having some add-ons in educational. Okay, similarly you are having geo, image analytics, network, then prototypes, then spectroscopy is again one of the area where you can actually do the analytics. So depending on which application you are working, or depending on in which application domain you are working, you can install this add-on and you can use those capabilities in the Orange software. So if you can see over here, so here just what you need to do, like suppose I want to install spectroscopy. So just click this, check the box, okay, and you have to press okay. Okay, of course you should have a live internet connection because it is fetching the libraries from internet and it is getting installed on your system. So likewise, you can install this one by one on your system. So I think it is pretty easy to do it. Okay, so just you have to go to add-on option, may you have to go to add-ons and just select whichever add-on you want to install. Okay, and just press okay, so that add-ons get installed on your system. And you have to restart the Orange. Okay, you don't need to restart your system. You just need to restart the Orange software, and it will. You can see at the left hand side that particular section is now available. So let me just quickly explore or show you. So in image analytics, you can see here, mostly it is working on images. Yeah. So just if you're not having idea about this, so again, when we say we want to classify the images, so lot many images are available, maybe millions of images are available, and you want to categorize them, okay, according to their features. So first of all, you need to extract some statistical features out of it. Maybe the features are statistical features, or they may be visual features, okay, and those features has to be extracted. And now you can apply some kind of machine learning on those features, and you can actually categorize those data. Okay, so that is the form of image analytics. Okay, so I'll be showing you one example so that it will be pretty clear to you. Now coming to this two, text table and text mining. Okay, so I guess this field again, it is not a new field. Many people are working in text analytics, and various algorithms are available. People are using. So here, lot many widgets are available which you can use, and you can do some text analytics. I'll be showing you few, okay, if time permits. And of course, a very important thing over here, I would like to show is time series. Okay, so you might have heard that every day we are working with stock and all. Okay, so if you want to do some kind of stock prediction, if you want to do some kind of weather forecasting, okay. So mostly time series data is playing a crucial role in that. You are having lot much of data, historical data, and based on that data, okay, by seeing the trend and all those things, okay, you can predict what will happen in future. You can predict maybe what will happen in next day, or what will happen in next week or month or year and so. Okay, so that kind of thing is also available over here. So you can download the time series data from internet, or if you are having your own data, you can use that data and you can run some model. There are many models available which is helping you to do the time series analysis or to do the forecasting or prediction by using time series analysis. So you can use those things and you can easily predict it. Okay, so as you are the from statistic background, you are knowing the importance of this prediction and forecasting. Okay, and all those things are actually dependent on which models you are using, and the models are based on some mathematical foundation, of course, the statistics only. Okay, so this thing is also available. So I'll be showing you some case studies from this section also. So this is just a little bit introduction about the widget. Okay, widget section. Here it is not possible for me to actually take each and every widget and explain in detail, but I will try to take most of the widgets so that you can get the overview about that, and later you can explore the other widgets. Okay, I'll be giving you some references where you can get more information about Orange, and you can just go through the tutorials which are available and you can learn it. So let me just show you. If you can go over here, you can see the video tutorials. So on YouTube, there is a separate channel, or there is a channel called as Orange Tutorial. So, and very small videos are present. So you can just go to that tutorial and you can learn small things, okay, using those videos. And some documentation is available from Orange itself. Okay, I'll be sharing that link with you. So you can go through that documentation, and it will be easier for you to understand and learn many things, and the basic thing on which whole Orange is relying, or whole analytics is relying. Okay, so that thing is available. And now if you can see, as I mentioned, this window or this white portion which I am showing you, that is called as workspace. Okay, and here we can actually drag and drop the widgets, and we can generate a workflow. Okay. So let me now quickly tell you how we can use these widgets, okay, and in what way you can do some experimentation using these widgets. So before that, can I just get a quick feedback? The you people are with me, and you are able to understand whatever I have given you the brief about the Orange. Can I just get a quick feedback?
Yes, ma'am. We can. We are with you.
Okay, thank you so much. So I'll proceed further now. So now this is very important part. Everybody has to be little, vigilant about this, because you need to understand how the widgets are taken and in what way they can be used. Okay, so I'll be starting with the very first widget, that is data. Because whenever we want to do certain analytics, our main source of this thing is data. Okay, if data is not there, we cannot do anything. So of course, data should be there. So for every analysis which we are performing, we need to take some kind of data as an input. Okay, so how to take that data as an input? So whenever you want to use that data, you can, as I mentioned, it can come from any source. It can come from Access data or CSV file, or maybe a database, or maybe some kind of sources from internet. Okay, so depending on which you want to use, you can select appropriately. So currently I am using the data sets which are already available in Orange, and you don't need to download it. It is already coming up with the Orange itself for doing some basic experimental work. Okay, so when you want to do, there are two ways to use this widget. First thing is you can just drag and drop them in the workspace. Okay, so that widget is dropped over here, or you know the name of the widget. So what you can do, you can just right click. Okay, and you can put the name of, you can type the name of that widget, and you can just click on this. Okay, so these are two ways to actually get the widget in your workspace. Okay. Both way can do. So now this is my file widget, which is helping me to take the input data for analytics. Okay. Now you can see over here, this particular widget is shown as the circle. And if you can see, this is a dotted line, okay, at the right-hand side. Okay. Similarly, some of the widgets are having dotted line at the left-hand side also. Okay. So let me just take one more widget. So I'm just giving you the example. So this is one more widget. So if you can see on this particular widget, there is a dotted line on left-hand side as well as dotted line on right-hand side. Okay. So now let me tell you what is the difference between this. Okay. So you can see this is called as this, the dotted line at the left-hand side. Okay. That is called as left channel. Okay. And the one which is at right-hand side, that is called as right channel. Okay. Always the left channel is taking the input, okay, which is passed to this particular widget, and the right channel is actually used to pass the output to some other widget. Okay, so always keep this in mind that it is left is for input, right is for output. Okay, now if you can see for this widget, okay, there is no input we can pass to this widget, only output we can actually send. So if you can hover your mouse on that widget, okay, just let me go. Yeah. So you can see it's a file widget, no input, and output is data. Okay, so for every widget, you can actually get this. So now if you can see over here, if I take this test and score, so if you can see here, I can take input as well as I can produce the output. Now, what kind of input can be taken, that is also mentioned over there. So here, if you can see for this particular widget, okay, the input can be data. It can be a test data, it can be a learner, or it can be a pre-processor, okay? Or maybe, just let me hover one more time. Yeah, and so this kind of four inputs I can actually take, and it can be passed to this particular widget as an input. And now this widget is capable to produce the output, okay? And what kind of output it is producing? It is producing the output as predictions, okay? Or it is producing the output as evaluation result. Okay, so it is producing as evaluation result. So likewise, for every widget, you are having that particular thing. So just keep in mind, if you want to produce something as an output, it should have a output channel associated with it, that is right channel associated with it, then only you can produce some output. Okay, if you want to take some input, okay, then the left channel should be present, otherwise you cannot take the input. So whenever you want to use any widget, okay, you can drag and drop, or you can just right click and put the name over here, and you can use that widget. Okay, so that is how you can put the widget in your workspace. Now, next thing is how to take the data inside your workspace. So as I have taken this file, so now just double click on this. Okay, when you double click on this, okay, it is showing you the way to take the input. So here, if you can see here, these are the tables which are already available in orange. So if you can see this iris data, so those who have worked in little bit in data science field or in data mining field, so this is a standard, very popular data set which every data scientist is being using for experimental purpose. Okay, so these are few sample data sets which are available in orange. So they are Titanic data, then iris data, then housing data, heart disease data, then brown selected data, and zoo data. I'll be taking different data for different experimentation so that you can actually see what that data is actually showing. Okay? And if you can see over here, just let me again double click. Okay? If you can see over here, it is also allowing you to take the data from other sources also. If it is not there available in orange, and if you are downloaded from somewhere, okay, and if you want to use that data, so you can use that data, okay, by just browsing it. Okay, of course, you can keep that data anywhere and you can browse and you can use that data. Also, if you want to download some data from internet, okay, if you want to fetch some data from internet, so you need to put here URL. Just put the URL and the data is fetched and it is now ready for processing. So it will be available in this file and it is ready for processing. So now currently I am using this iris tab, iris data. And let me tell you, this iris data, it's a flower data set. Okay. So this particular data is having 150 records. Okay. And this particular data is having 4 attributes. Okay. 4 columns are there and 150 rows are there. So what columns they are having? They are having the column as sepal length, sepal width, petal length, and petal width. Okay. So this particular 4 features are there. Okay. So when you are seeing the data, 4 features means the attributes or the column in the table, and 150 instances means number of rows in the table. So if you want to see that data, okay, now there is one widget called as data table. Okay, so if you want to see a data in tabular format, okay, you can see that data by using data table. Okay, so how to see that? So again, same thing, you can drag and drop this, okay. And now I want to pass the data which is available in this file, okay, as an input to this data table. Okay, so you can see the input I can pass to this as a data, and output can be a data or selected data. So in this case, now I need to connect this widget, file widget, to this data table widget. So how to connect it? So it's pretty easy. Just you have to go to the channel, okay, and drag your mouse and release it over here. Okay, so now here there is a connection established between this file and data table, and now it is showing you this is the channel established between this particular file widget and data table, and through this channel a data from this file is passed to this data table. Okay, now whatever we have seen that here 4 columns are there and 150 rows are there, so the complete data is now passed to this data table. And you, if you click this, you can see that in tabular format. So let me just show you in tabular format. Yeah. So if you can see over here, as I mentioned here, okay, this is 4 features: sepal length, sepal width, petal length, and petal width. Okay. And if you can see here, 1, 2, 3, 4 till you are having 150 records. So you are having 150 instances. Okay. So in this way, you can actually see the table. Okay, and now if you can see one more thing, if you notice, okay, depending on this particular features, okay, it is getting divided into 3 different classes. Okay, so the classes are iris setosa, okay, if you can see, then iris versicolor, and if you can see the third one, iris virginica. Okay, so these 3 classes are there. Depending on these values, this classification is done. Of course, if you want to classify it in more classes, you need to specify the condition, and based on that you can have the classification also. But by default this is coming like this only. Okay, so in this way you can actually take the data and you can see the data. Okay, so this is one way to take the data. Now suppose if you want to delete particular widget, so just select that widget and press delete, so that particular widget get deleted and all associated channels, incoming channels as well as outgoing channel, that will be also deleted. So if you can see here, the link which was there between file and data table, that automatically goes off. So that is one thing. Now if you want to, as I told you earlier, that you can drag and drop this data table, or you can right click and you can put your data table and you can use that. Or the third way is you can just start dragging your mouse, okay, and just release over here, okay, and you can select whatever widget you want to use. So now you can use here data table. So these are three ways you can actually use the widget in your workspace. Okay, so once you have a practice, you can use this particular method because it's very pretty easy to do it. Okay, if you are naive user of Orange, then probably try to use this method, drag and drop, or just right click and try to select from this, okay, and use it. Okay, so I hope it is clear how to take the widget inside the workspace. Okay, now I'll be concentrating on some of the statistical parameters which you can actually see, and what kind of various widgets which are available, which will help you to do that. Okay, so if you just to give you some gist of that, I'll be sharing two screens with you. Okay, let me just tell me whether the screens are visible, both the screens are visible or not. Can you see one image which I have opened along with the Orange software?
Yes, ma'am.
Can I get? Yes, ma'am. Yeah. So yeah, so this I am showing you because you should get a feel that how it will look like when I'll be completing or I'll be showing that. Okay, so that's why I'm just putting it side by side so that you can refer it if you are doing the hands on along with me. If not, do not worry. I'll be passing all these things to you people. Later on, you can go through it one by one and you can do it by your own. Okay, so once you understand, it is easy. Just you need to remember that these are the widgets which has to be used for this particular work. Okay, and you can do it. And once you have a practice, you will remember for which task, which widget is used, and accordingly you can use it. Okay, so now the first thing I'll be showing you. Okay. That how to see the simple statistical parameters from the data. Okay, so now for that, as here I'll be showing you that image. Let me just manage my screen so that yeah. Now I hope both the portions are visible. So now first I need to take a file. Okay, I need to take a data over here. Okay, so now you can take any data which is available over here, or if you want to take your own data, you can take that data. So currently I have taken this iris data only. I'll be showing you how to change it and see it. Okay, and if I want to see the in the tabular format, already we have seen how to do it. So file and data table widget I am using now. What I want to do, I want to now see various features from this data. So now for that, this particular widget called as feature statistics can be used. Okay, so now what you can do, it is available over here. Okay, in maybe it is in visualization, sorry, it is in it is available somewhere in this thing, or you can just right click and you can put here feature statistics. Okay, so this will come over here, feature statistics. Now it is having both the channels, input as well as output. Okay, so now for this feature statistics, the input has to be given as this content of the file. So what you have to do, you have to just connect this widget with this feature statistics widget. So now if you can see, I can just connect it. Okay. And now the data from this file is being passed to this feature statistics. Okay. And now if you can see over here, I'm just double clicking it. Okay. And if you can see over here, I had four features. If you can see here, I had four features: sepal length, sepal width, petal length, and petal width. And these are the data values which are present for this particular field, for sepal width, for petal length, and petal width. Okay, so this is my data table. Okay, and now when I want to construct the statistics from this, okay, so if you can see, it is showing me, like, for every feature, it is showing me the histogram of that particular values. Okay, so whatever the values you are seeing over here, say for sepal length, you are seeing that so many values are present over here, okay, in this particular domain. Okay, and now if you can see over here for this particular, say, let's take here, I'm taking petal length, okay, this values. Okay, so if you can see, if you double click it, it is showing you the distribution of those values in the histogram. Okay, and if you can see over here again, let me just zoom, maximize it. Yeah, so if you can see over here, it is showing me basic features, okay, which you can extract from it. So it is showing me what is the minimum value, okay, what is the maximum value, okay, then it is showing me the center and the dispersion. These two things are shown. Now if you can observe here, the data which is present in the table or in the file, that data may be a numeric data, or it may be a categorical data. Okay, so now if it is a categorical data, this center, this particular center, okay, this is nothing but a mode. If it is categorical data, it is showing you a mode, and if it is a numeric data, it is showing you mean value. Okay, so now for example, this iris data is a numerical data, so that's why this center is nothing but it is showing you the mean of those values. So whatever the values present in that table, in that particular column, petal width, the mean is calculated and it will be directly shown to you over here. Similarly, if you can see over here, this dispersion, okay, so this dispersion is nothing but it is, now if the data or the features are categorical features, this dispersion is nothing but the entropy. Okay, the entropy is calculated and it is shown over here. And if the data is numerical, okay, then in that case, this dispersion is nothing but it is showing you the coefficient of variation. Okay, so now currently this is the numerical data, so it is showing me the coefficients of variation in the values of those particular data. Okay, so by using this, you can find out very simple parameters, statistical features from that particular data. And also, if some values are missing, that values are also pointed out over here. But now here currently this data is up to date and no value is missing. Okay, so in this way, you can actually see the basic statistical features from the data. Okay, now let me just change the data so that you can get a feel how it is changing. So now I am using here maybe zoo data. Okay, so I have selected zoo data. Just you need to select and close it, so automatically it gets selected. And let me show you that data first. Okay, so if you can see over here, it is having 101 instances, means 101 rows are present. Okay, and it is having 16 features, means 16 columns are there. So as it is zoo data, it is showing you the information about the animals which are present in the zoo. So what kind of features or attributes which we can use to represent those particular animals? Okay, these are present over here. So like name of that animal, hair, then feather, then eggs, milk, air, bone. So whether it is present or not, depending on that, value 1 or 0 is present. Okay, where they are aquatic, where they are predator, where they are what we can say, the venomous, or all these features they are having, whether they are having tail or they are domestic or this thing. So likewise, many features are considered. Likewise, 16 features are considered, and you will be having the values of those features over here. Okay, and of course, depending on the
Just a minute. Sorry for the disturbance. So if you can see over here, depending on this features value, actually they are categorized as whether they are mammals or they are reptile or bird and all those things. Okay, so this is a basic data. Now if you can see over here the feature statistics, so now you can see, so they are little different. If you can see now, some of the data, okay, are categorical data and some of the data is numerical data. So most of the data is categorical over here. That's why you cannot have mean and max of that, but you can get here the center and dispersion. So here you can get the center as modes like this and dispersion as entropy value. Okay. So depending on what kind of data you are using, okay, you will be getting the statistics about that. Of course, you people are knowing in what particular data, what kind of statistical feature can be extracted. So likewise, depending on which data set you are having in hand, okay, this particular simple statistical parameters can be calculated, or they can just, means like here minimum and maximum we cannot calculate because this is the categorical data. Okay. If it is numerical data, it is easily, we can calculate minimum and maximum. Okay. So that is the basic thing. If you want to find out some basic features, then you can do this. Now, of course, here, if you can see, if you want to present these features in tabular format, okay, again, what you can do, you can just have a data table over here. Okay. And now, if suppose you want to see only, so you have to select, okay, which kind of features you want to use. So right, just you have to press shift and select. So here I am selecting this particular file, this thing, and just close it. Okay, you don't need to save and all, just select it and close it. Okay, now if you can see earlier, let me just go back and one more time show you so that you can easily understand it. I'm just deselecting now. Okay. So now here I have not selected anything. Okay. Or maybe I'll just delete it. Okay. And now again, I'll be putting it. I just wanted to show you what is the impact of this thing. So again, I'll be using here feature statistics. Okay. This is calculated. Okay. And now if I want to show that in a data table, okay, here I can show. But now if you can observe over here, here it is showing you the dotted line. Okay. Dotted line shows that it is not, the input is not passed in appropriate way. Means some flaw is there in selection of the data. So if you can see over here, it is showing you reduced data to data. Okay. And mostly this day, whenever you see such kind of dotted line, okay, so the requirement of this is whatever input you are having, okay, whole thing will not be passed as an input to the next wizard. You have to select whatever thing which you want to pass. So now I'm just selecting this, okay, and closing it. So now you can observe this dotted line earlier, this becomes, as soon as I selected this, this dotted line becomes thick line. Okay. And now, the data from this, the selected data from this will be sent to the data table, and you can see the values over here. So only that many things are used. So I'll just show you both the things together, then only you can get this thing. Yeah. So now if you can see, this is my table where I have selected cat size, domestic, tail, legs, fins, and venomous. So these things will be appearing over here, and you can actually get only the information about that. Okay. So in this way, one can actually play with this and one can get the information about that. Okay. So I hope it is understood, because this is very simple exercise, and just to get a simple statistical parameters, you can do this. Okay. Now just to, in addition to this, okay, there is one option called as transpose. Okay. So I'll just show you. These are very simple thing, but they are very important and plays a very important role in when you are doing some kind of analysis. So this transpose, as I mentioned earlier, if you want to transpose the data, like if you want to make a rows to column and column to rows, okay, then you can use this. So now what I'll be doing, I'm just passing same file to this transpose, okay? And now I'll be making a table over here, okay? And here you can see transpose may, it is asking you to select, okay? See, some of the things are available over there, some of the parameters, you can select it, okay? Or if you want to keep those as default, you can keep as default also, okay? So here it is asking you, okay, that by default now it is name is placed over here, but as this is zoo data, maybe from some other data, I'll just try to change this data and I'll make this as iris data, okay? And now if you can see over here, it is changing. So now I can have these four things and I can select, okay? And accordingly you can have, and if I click this, okay, now you can see over here, okay? So earlier this sepal length, sepal width, petal length and petal width, this were the columns in my table. If you can see this table, these were the columns, okay? And now when I made a transpose, this becomes rows. So just if you want to change the rows to columns and columns to rows, you can do that, okay, by using the transpose, okay? So of course, for here, you will not actually get the correct use of transpose, but actually when you are doing the analytics, there are many places where you need to actually make a row as column and column as row. So that time, this kind of functionality can be used, okay? So this is one mechanism. So I hope all are with me and all are understanding this, how it is being done, okay? And if you want to delete, yeah, next thing is if you want to save this, okay, if you want to save this workspace, whatever thing you have done, you can just go to file and you can save this. So you can save, okay, or you can just click on save. And it is saving this particular workspace by the extension OWS. It stands for Orange Workspace. OWS stands for Orange Workspace. So you can just save this workspace and later on you can load it and you can use it for your experimentation purpose. Okay, so that is the way you can actually save the workspace. So currently I'm not saving it. Okay, if you want to delete a whole thing, just select it. Just select the portion. So the workspace will be clear. So this is one thing. Now the next thing is when you are working with the data, okay, sometimes the data is in discrete form, okay, and you need a data to be in a continuous, you want the data to be represented, so you want the data to be represented in a continuous variable format. So that time there are features available in Orange where you can discretize the data, or you can make the data from discrete data to continuous data. Okay, so now let me show you how to do that. So one more time, I'm taking one file and here I am taking iris data, and this is showing me the discrete value. Okay, we already seen, say if I want to show that, you can see these are discrete values. Okay, now if you want to continuous that data, or if you want to make that data as continuous, there is one tool or there is one widget called as continuous. Okay, so you can use this continuous widget. Okay, and using this widget, you can actually make that data, convert that data from discrete to continuous data. Okay, now when you're doing that, you need to do some kind of settings. Okay, so if you double click on this, okay, you can see here a different thing. So you need to do some setting at categorical features. You need to do some setting for numeric features and for the categorical outcome. So maybe some for this categorical features, just I'm using the first value as base value. Of course, you can just try different options available over here, and you can make that discrete data into, you can change that discrete data into continuous data. Now here the numeric features, okay, like here we have a numeric features, okay, Okay. So if you want to make the numeric or if you want to retain the numeric feature as it is, you can do that. Okay. If you want to standardize the numeric values, okay, by keeping some standard deviation and all those things, okay, so that also you can do. Okay, if you want to normalize them into some specific range, that is, if you want to normalize them into -1 to 1, okay, you can normalize them. Or if you want to normalize them between 0 to 1, that can also be done. So let's say here by default it is normalized to interval 0 to 1. Okay. And this categorical outcome, we are leaving it as it is. We are not changing it. Of course, you can do the experimentation and change it. Now, when I am doing this and I am one more time, whatever the things are done over here, the processing is done. And now the data which is coming from this file is now modified and we'll be getting this in the tabular format. So when you click this, okay, you can see the data. Okay, so if I'll show you the original data, this is my original data. Okay, and this is my continuous data, or this is the data showing the discrete value, and this is the data which is showing me the continuous value, or simply the data is normalized, okay, between the range 0 to 1. Okay, so all data is actually normalized between 0 to 1. Okay, and it is showing you now the continuous data. So in this way, you can actually change the data from discrete to continuous. Same way you can do the reverse way also. Okay, you can, if you have a continuous data, you can discretize it or you can randomize it. Okay, so those features are also available. So depending on what kind of experimentation you are using and what kind of application is in hand and the requirement of reprocessing of the data, you can do such kind of things. Okay. Of course, here when you are doing that, okay, you have to take care that which kind of setting you are applying, because depending on that, the data values are being changed. Okay, so one need to very cautious when selecting these things. Okay, so that is one of the feature which is available in Orange. Okay, now coming to the next, again I'll be just showing you different things. Okay. So now if I'm taking file again, iris data. So same thing I'll be doing for this data table I have. Okay. Now, if you can see over here, okay, if I show you the data here, you're having a target with 3 values. So basically it is having 3 classes. The whole data is being divided into 3 classes. One is setosa, iris setosa. Second one is iris versicolor. And third one is iris virginica. Okay. So now if suppose you want to create a new class. Okay. So you can create a new class also. So what you need to do, you need to actually use a wizard called as create class. You need to use this wizard, pass this data to the wizard. Okay. And just double click on this. Okay. So if you can see over here, it is showing you versicolor, virginica and city. So this I have already done earlier. So if I am not putting this, okay, it is showing me like 50 instances are for versicolor and 100 instances are for this C2. Okay. If you want to add one more class, just click on plus sign and put here whatever the class name by default it is coming over here. If you want to give some name over here, like I'm giving your name as virginica. Okay, so that thing you can also do. Okay, and this particular instance, of course, whenever you are giving the name, that should be appropriate. Okay, and accordingly, these instances will get distributed to these classes, and you can see those classes. So for time being, you just keep in mind that if you want to create multiple classes, you can just use this create class, and you can just add plus. Okay, and you can do that. Now, if you want to see this, okay. There is one plot called as scatter plot. You might be aware about scatter plot. Okay. So if you can see here, I just put here scatter plot. If you want to see that plot over here, okay, here you can see different plots are available. So this is the wizard for scatter plot. So you can drag and drop, or you can directly right click and use that as a scatter plot. Just put the first name and or this will automatically come over here and you can use it. Okay. So now we have used your scatter plot and it and see it. Okay, so here it is showing you like the classes. Okay, so currently it is showing you, just let me select it. So currently it is showing C1, C2, C3, three classes, okay, because fourth ka instances I have not added. So if you can see over here, it is showing me C1, C2, C3. Fourth ka nothing is added yet, okay, but you can add it. And it is showing me the three classes over here, C1, C2, and C3. Okay, and of course here, the one which is in gray color, okay, the one which is in gray color, let me just show you by putting this, yeah. So if you can see here, the C1 class, it is shown by blue color. The C2 class is shown by red color. C3 class is shown by green color. And if you can see, the gray color samples are also there. Because here I have not done the proper setting. It is not properly visualized. But here you can do the proper setting and you can have the all 150 instances. You can categorize over here and you can add the class over here. Okay, so right now you just I'm holding this. I'll show you this when I'll show you this scatter plot in detail. Okay, so in this way you can create a class. Okay, if you want to actually put some more number of categorization in your data. Okay, now coming to the next feature which is available. So I'm just deleting this part and rest this thing I am keeping as it is. Okay. Now, as I mentioned here, we have seen how to make a discrete data to continuous data. Now, one more feature is available that is called as randomize. Okay. So again, you can drag and drop or you can just select here. So this is randomize feature. Okay. So you can see over here, it is available over here itself. You can see randomize feature is widget is available. So you can drag and drop or you can use like this. Okay. So when you click on this, okay, it is actually randomizing the data. Okay, you can select whether you want to shuffle the columns based on classes or features or some metadata and how much randomization you want to do. So here 80% is selected. Okay, now let me show you how it is seen. So one more time, you can just see the result by putting in data table. So now this is my new table, which is randomized version of this particular data. So let me show you both, then it will be clear. So this is my original table and this is my randomized table. So if you can see over here, I'll just go back. Yeah. So if you can see over here, the values are taken into consideration. Okay. And here as thing, we have not done any changes over here, but if I just do here, I'm using features and I'm just using some randomization. I'm just changing it. Okay. And now you can probably see this data and this data. Yeah. So now you can observe over here. Okay. This is my original data. Okay. And now I have done the randomization. So whole values are getting changed over here. Okay, because I applied the randomization. Let me go back and show you. I have applied randomization on features. So these are nothing but features. This sepal length, sepal width, petal length, and petal width. These are my features. And on these features, I have just randomized. So whatever the values which are present over here, the range is actually calculated and all the values are just randomized between that particular range. Okay. And how much shuffle you are doing. So again, the shuffle ratio is 51%. So they are just shuffled here and there and the values are simply randomized and you'll be getting this value. So here, if you can see over here, these are the values and these are randomized value. Okay. So the range will not change. Means if it is the petal sepal length value is between some range, maybe say 2.9 to 5.1, the range will not change. Only it is randomizing between the rows. Okay. So if you can see, I'll just show you with some demonstration. Okay. So now what I'll be doing, okay, I'm just showing you one, the other, this thing, visualization tool called as box plot. Okay. So now here, if I'm using here box plot, okay. Yeah. So I'm just trying to show you the box plot and I need to select all these things to show the box plot. So I have selected whole thing. Okay. And now I am showing here box plot. So let me first tell you what box plot is showing. Okay. So this actually box plot, I guess that some of you might be knowing this. Okay. That how the box plot are being used. Okay. But I'll just give you some brief overview about the box plot. Okay. So now here we have taken iris data. Okay, and I'm just showing you the box plot. So box plot is actually used to display the distribution of the values which are corresponding to that particular feature or that particular class. Okay, and it is showing you that values by showing the range of the value. Okay, the mean value of that particular values, and also showing the standard deviation. Mean, median, and standard deviation is shown over here. So if you can see in iris data, we are having three classes: iris setosa, iris versicolor, and iris virginica. So if I can take that, okay, and if I am selecting here, okay, if I am selecting sepal length, so for these three classes, it is showing me the range of this sepal length. So you can see range of the sepal length is 4.8 to 5.2. Okay, then for this particular class. For this class, it is 5.6 to 6.3. It is 6.2 to 6.9 for this virginica. Okay. And if you can see over here, there is a dark blue vertical line. Can you observe this dark blue vertical line in every box? Okay. So that dark blue vertical line is actually showing you the mean value. Okay. This mean value is shown over here. Okay. And if you can, now here currently it is not visible, but if you can see a thin blue line over there, that is showing you the standard deviation, and the yellow line, the yellow vertical line, which is visible over there. If you can see over here, yellow vertical line is there. This yellow vertical line is there. This yellow vertical line is there. So that is showing you the median. Okay. So likewise, see the mean, median, and standard deviation. Visualize those things by using this box plot. So here the thing is now, if you are seeing this box plot over here, okay, for this particular normal data, this is normal data. We have not done any randomization, and I can see this box plot. Now I have done the randomization, and now I'm going to show you the, I'm just going to show you the box plot for that. Yeah, I need to select the data. So I'll be selecting whole data. Let me just select. So I'm just selecting whole data. Yeah. Now, here also I have selected whole data, and this is my box plot. Okay. So I have used sepal length, and I just minimize this. Let me minimize this. So this is my, just let me show you both. This is my first box plot, which is original. Okay. And this is my second box plot. I don't know why it is not getting this thing, but if you can observe here, it is 4.8 to 5.6. Okay. Let me go and show you this. Okay. This is 4.8 to 5.2. So box plot is not getting changed because the range for that particular data set, it is not being changed. It is fixed. Only we are randomizing the value. We are shuffling the values between the rows. That's why both the box plots are identical. If you can see, both the box plots are identical. Okay. And here again, it is 5.8 to this thing. Okay. Maybe, yeah, some variation, or I have not selected the rows properly. Yeah, just let me go to this. Yeah. So if the moral of this thing is when you select whole data, okay, and when you draw the box plot, and when you randomize it and again select the data, the thing is not getting changed. Here I just changed the selected data. data, the section is actually not applicable now. So it is showing me the dotted line. But the thing, the data range is not getting changed. Okay, only the randomization is happening between the rows. So you can see only the 51% shuffling we are doing between the rows of these features, and the values are just shifted here and there. Okay, the range is not getting changed. Okay, or that's why the both the box plots are really identical. Okay, so you can do this for other data also, and you can see that. Okay, so that is one thing, the basic thing. And coming to the next features which you can use, let me just delete this one. Yeah, so there is one more feature available, okay, which is called as impute feature. Okay, so actually this particular impute feature is very important when you are taking some data from some data sources, and some of the values in those data sets are actually not present, means they are actually not known. Okay, or sometimes they are blank. Okay, so if you want to work with that, then you can use this particular feature. Why I am telling, because when you start doing the experimentation, or when you start doing some analytics on data, okay, these basic things are very important, and some kind of pre-processing you need to do on your data. So that's why these things are important. And if you can do the pre-processing, your data will be in proper format, and the accuracy of the system will be better when compared to the data with some anomalies. Okay. As I mentioned you, box plot. So this box plot can also be used to see some kind of anomalies, like if you are having some duplicated values, those duplicated values are shown by gray colors. Now, fortunately, here we are using tested data, and this data is a very ideal data for doing the experimentation. So as such, there is no repeated values or as such. But when you are working on real data set, okay, that time it may happen that there are multiple values or duplicated values are present over there. So if you want to see whether the duplicated values are there or not, so this tools like box plot can be helping you to see the duplicated values, and they are shown in gray colors. Okay, so if you can take a data and just plot by using box plot, and if you can find a gray color portion over there, immediately you will come to know that some duplicate data is there, and you can remove that duplication, and then you can work with that data. Similarly, if some kind of outliers are present, like we know that specific range is there for the data, like say for iris petal length, we are having the range like 4.8 to 5.6. okay, but there are some outliers, okay, which is, or there are some specific record which is having the value as say 10.9. So it is not justifiable value, because the normal range of that data is between 4.8 to 5.2, but now the value which you are getting as certainly a very different value, like 10.6 or so. So in that case, we are calling that value, or we are representing that as an outlier. So the box plot is a visual tool through which you can actually see such kind of outliers. Okay, so here as we are using standard data set, no such duplicate records are present, duplicate values are present. At the same time, outliers are not present. But if you are taking the data, like if you are having any data which you have collected from students, Excel file or CSV file, so you can take that data as an input and try to plot it by using box plot. So if any redundant records are there or duplicate data are there, that will be visualized, that will be visible by gray color. And if any outlier is there, then that can be also shown in the box plot. Okay, so this kind of visualization tools are actually very useful, and you can get lot many features of the data set from those features. Okay, so that is the box plot. Okay, now just a minute, I guess
ma'am, shall we have 5 to 10 minutes break in between?
Yes, no problem. So okay
You let me know when you want to take a break, then we'll give them 5 minutes break, 5 to 7 minutes break.
Yeah. So maybe the rest part or the other visualization visits I'll continue after break. Okay, so we'll have a break, and after that I'll continue with the visualization tool and then some of the case studies.
All participants are almost there. Some of them have left, but they will join in a minute or two. So we can start now.
Okay.
I think Soham had asked a question and you have answered his question on the chat box. So I think we can start with the further illustrations.
Yeah. And maybe in the last, I'll take all the questions.
Yes, ma'am. We'll take the questions at the end.
By unmuting themselves, so it will be easier then.
Yes, ma'am.
Yeah, so welcome back again, all the participants. And now I'll be showing you some of the more visualization, and then we will be seeing some case studies or how we can actually do analytics by using different widgets which are available in Orange. Okay, so I showed you the box plot. Okay. Now the next plot, which I'll just like to show you, is the distribution. So if you can see over here, it is all these plots are available in visualization. If you can see in visualize section, all the visualization tools are available or widgets are available. But let me just tell you that for each of the type of the data, okay. Or we cannot use all the visualization tool for any kind of data. Okay, so we need to appropriately select the visualization tool depending on what data we are having in hand and what kind of analysis actually we are doing on that particular data. Okay, so like I just shown you the scatter plot, but from that you didn't get any information. But now when I'll show you, when I'll be performing the categorization of the data into different clusters, then that time probably see how the scatter plot is being used over there to show visualization of those categorization. Okay, so maybe once we have a practice of using that, you will come to know that what is the power of this plot and in what way it can be used for visualization. So that was the box plot. Now coming to the distribution, so you can drag and drop, or you can actually just right click and get it. So I'm using here the same iris tab data, okay? And now I'm passing it to the distribution widget, okay? And now if you can click on widget, again to show the data, I have a data table. This is the normal thing, which we already seen over here, okay? And now if you can click on distribution, it is giving you the histogram of that particular data. Now, depending on what kind of values we are having, okay, the nature of the plot is being changed. Okay, so here, if you can see here, it is having the, if you are selecting particular features of that data, okay, then you'll be getting the different things over there, like, it is getting changed. The histogram of that particular thing is getting changed. Now, let me just change your data set. I'm just going to change the data set now. Instead of iris, suppose I'm taking here zoo data. Okay, I have just reloaded and I have just used zoo data. Okay, and now I'm just seeing the distribution. So again, here you can see the distributions over here. Okay, and like you can see, these are the different this thing. So if you can see here, just a minute, my mouse is probably, yeah. So here you can see the hair is taken on the x-axis and frequency is taken on x-axis. And you can see here the bins are shown, okay?
And here it is showing you the beans for different this thing, like reptile, mammal, then invertebrate and all this thing. Okay. So here now I have selected this. If you can select here feeders, okay. Here on x-axis, I'll be getting feeders and here frequency. And these are the classes of those animals. And you can see the visualization of those classes. Okay. Like what is the frequency of that particular features for this class that is shown over here. So if I'm changing this, you will be getting different distribution of those frequency of occurrences of those. Okay. Yeah. So in this way, I can just go on selecting. Okay, this thing. And now here, if you can see, there are many other things which you can use to control this. Okay. So here, if you want to split the columns by a particular type, so you can split by, now I have selected here type. If you want to split by hair, then you can split it. You can split by egg. Okay. So likewise, you can also split this thing. Okay. So currently I'm putting it by default type so that I can see all the classes and their this thing. Okay. If you want to, again, control your visualization, if you want to show the probabilities, okay, so you can also see the probabilities over here. Okay, so here, probability of type at given domestic. Okay, so likewise, you can see the probability. If you want to see the cumulative distribution, you can see the cumulative distributions also. Okay, if you want to stack the column like this, one over another, you can use that. Okay, so depend. You can just control the visualization in what way you want to show. Okay, so this is for zoo. Let me just select the other this thing. Yeah, I'm just now using iris maybe. Okay, so now one more time I am showing you like this. Okay, and I'm just removing this. Okay, and here if you can see here, you can have a distribution like this. Now earlier I have not selected anything, but here you can select. So here the distribution which for the visualization, whichever distribution you want. So say for example, I have used gamma distribution. So it is showing me by putting that value, like if I am using here Rayleigh distribution. So again, it is showing me, likewise, depending on what kind of visualization you want to show, okay, you can actually use those kind of visualization or you can use. Now here I'm using exponential. So it is showing me like this. Okay. So one can actually use such kind of different control measures which are available in the distribution to show the complete distribution of the features which are available in that data set. Okay. So right now here only we are having four features and we are having three classes, but depending on the data, you might be having more number of features and more classes. So the way in which you want to visualize them, okay, or the way by which you want to show the distribution of it, you can select and you can actually visualize this, because sometimes we need to show like the sigmoidal distribution and all, okay, or the Gaussian kernel density estimation and all. So that by using that, you can actually select from this list, okay, and you can control it. Similarly, here these are just few this thing. If you want to just change the size of the bin and all, you can control this particular parameter. So by using this, so basically distribution is distribution map is used to show you the distribution of the features or attributes, and you can control it by changing the parameters which are present over here. Okay, so I'll be showing you how it will be used when we'll see the example in next this thing. Okay, so this is the second visualization called as distribution. Okay, now coming to the next visualization, so that is called as heat map. Okay, so the heat map, if you can see over here, this is the widget called as heat map. Okay, so this heat map widget is actually used to show the pair of attributes. Okay, and it is only working for the continuous variables. Okay, so now say for example, I am selecting here, let's try some other data set. Okay, let's try this housing data set, and now I'm using this heat map. Okay, so just pass this, I'm just making here a data table so that you can see what data it is having. So if you can see here, it is having the features, 13 features are there. Okay, like CRIM, then ZN, Indus, and NOX, RM, and all those things. Okay, so various features are available over here. Okay, related to the housing data set, and here the values are present over here like this. Okay, now if suppose I am selecting here heat map and passing this file to heat map. Okay, so now I have passed the input to the heat map, and let me show you how the heat map is generated. Okay, so as I mentioned, the heat map actually is showing you the pair of attributes. Okay, so here if you can observe, okay, the color which is used over here is blue and green color. Okay, so let me just show you how it is showing you the feature and what kind of information we can obtain from this. So here, just let me just zoom it a little bit, maximize it. Yeah. So of course, here I'm just going to show this in this color. If you want to change the color, you can change the color, whichever color you want, you can show that color. Okay. And here, if you can see, it is showing you range 0 to like 711. So this is the lowest range and this is the highest range. So these are nothing but the values which corresponds to all the attributes. Okay, the range of the values which corresponds to all the attributes, like 0 to 711. Okay, it is the range which is given to that. Okay, and it is showing you the attributes, okay, which are actually concentrated on the lower end of the values or higher end of the values. So if you can see over here, these are the attributes, okay, which are mostly having the values, okay, or we can say this CRIM, ZN, and this Indus, they are having the values which are going towards the low end, okay, or low threshold, and these are going towards high threshold, and this particular like G and TAT, okay, these from this, you can see from tax to this tax onward, these four attributes or this particular pairs are showing you the highest value. And if you can see the last, this yellow color, okay, so this is the place where you can see these are the highest values which are shown over here. Okay, so basically if you want to see the attribute values and like how the pairing has been happened and the range of the values, so you can use this heat map over here. And of course, if you want to see only the specific attribute, if now here it is showing me for all the attributes, if you want to see for a specific attribute, that also you can do. Or if you want to control this, that also you can do. So currently what it is doing, that it is between this from 0 to 711, like from this dark blue color to this yellow color, it is actually dividing that color palette into 50 different ranges. Okay, because if you can see here, the clusters are set as 50. So if now currently, just as it is visualization, you might not see that, but there are various variations. You can see color variations are there. So they are showing you the different ranges of this. And if you can hover your mouse, you can see the different values of that. Okay, so for different values, different color patches are used. And here, such 50 patches are being used. You can change it and you can see the difference also. Okay, so there are many things which you can control. If you want to remove the legend, you can just uncheck this. Okay, if you want to add some over there, you can add the annotation. So just for representation purpose, and if you want to save it, like sometime we need to, if you have a data and if you are showing the visualization, so if you want to produce it as a image, you want to put it in some research article and all. So what you can do, you can just save. Here you can see the save option. So you can just save, you can click on save. So whatever the visualization which you got over here, okay, that can be saved as a PNG file. Okay. So like, let me just save this as sample PNG. Okay. So now I'm just saving this as sample.png. So it gets saved. And here, if I can show you, yeah. So now it is shown me like this, but now here it is incomplete. So you can add some kind of legends and everything, and you can show that as a real plot of the visualization of the this thing. the analytics. So here I'm just showing you the normal visualization. We'll see how it can be used in analytics also. Okay. So that's the way you can use. And now suppose I don't want all the features. So what I can do, I can just go to this just a minute. I can select the file. Okay. So what I'll do before this heat map, okay, I'll just delete this. And before this heat map, because I don't want whole data. So what I'll do, I'll be just using here select column feature widget. So this select column, if you observed here, it was somewhere here. Yeah, select column. Okay, and select rows. So I don't want to complete all the rows, all the columns. So I just want to use very specific and some two or three features or column from that. So I need to use a select column, and then whatever output I get from this, that I can pass to heat map. So currently I have not done any setting over here. So I'll see all the things over here. Okay, now what I'll do, I'll just go to this select column. And if you can see over here, earlier I have just done this. So these are the available attributes or available features of that data. Now, whichever you want to put in your analysis, you just click this and put it. Okay, so here you just click it and put it like this. So what I'll do, I'll just, yeah. So 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, only 6 features I have taken. Now, if you can see here, it is from CRIM to LT, LS, TAT, okay? So now only this selected columns will be passed to the heat map, okay? And I'll be getting that heat map as this. So if you can see over here, only this attributes are selected, selected attributes are shown over here. Just a minute. Yeah, it is in a different way. Just let me show you like this. Yeah, sorry, I just told you in the where is that? This is the heat map. Yeah, so now just let me tell you that when I am filtering this, whatever the attribute remain over here in the right hand side, that will be shown over here. Okay, so now let me just remove some of this. Okay, so you can see only the attributes which are shown in this right hand side window. Okay, they will be shown over here, and rest of the attributes will be filtered out. So these are the attributes which are filtered out, and these are the attributes which are shown over here. So now suppose this also I don't want, I just want to keep only 2, like age of that and maybe tax. Okay, so now if you can see, only I have put 2 attributes over here, age and tax. Okay. So you can see here the heat map is generated, and again ranging the values between different range, and the color is assigned. So here now I am using 50. So let me just do this as 20. So probably when you see the range over here, okay, it is, just let me hover the mouse. It is not showing currently. Yeah, let me just do one more thing. I'll just represent this in data table. And now, so probably we cannot output the values of this heat map. Okay, just it is giving me the average value and all. But you can visualize and you can see various color patches over here, and they are actually pairing the attributes and showing the pair of attributes and their values over there. Okay, so if I am changing this, let me just change it to some other data set. maybe I'll take the Titanic data set. And so now one more thing you can notice over here, okay, that the data set which we have used, okay, it is not the data set with the continuous variables. So that's why here, if you can see here, it is showing you the error. If somewhere you are getting like this, okay, the red circle and with cross, so that means here no numeric features are available over there, or maybe you are having the data set which contains the categorical data, okay, or sometime you will be getting a yellow rectangle over there, so that will show you the warning sort of thing, okay. So that's why you should understand what kind of nature the data is having which you are taking in the system. Okay, let me take some other data and check whether it is doing. Okay, I'll take the hard disk data. So here you can see, again, I'll be having some categorical data. You can see the type of the data also, categorical and numeric data. Okay, so now if you can see that that particular error is now disappeared. Okay, and when you go to this select, okay, now I'll just take only few of them so that you can see it. Yeah, so I'm taking only this much, okay, and if you can see the heat map, it is showing me the heat map of that. Okay, so likewise you can actually do the visualization. There are many more things which you can do over here. I'm just giving you the brief overview so that you can get idea, and later on you can explore it at further extent. Okay, so that is the heat map. Okay, now coming to the next important this thing feature is called as a tree viewer. Okay, so now what I'll do, I'll just take a file, okay, and now here I'm taking, say, hard disk data only, or let me take iris only, and then we'll see how it is working. So I have iris data, I have represented that using data table, and now here when I want to represent it as tree, okay, I can simply represent it, or I can use your tree. Okay, so here when I use tree, okay, it is actually dividing that particular data into various categories based on some condition, and tree structure is actually generated. So to view that tree structure, you need to have some visualization tool, and using that only you can do that. So the visualization tool which is used for that is tree viewer. So you have to click on this. Okay, now let me first show what is this tree and then what is tree viewer. So if you can click on tree, okay, it is showing you the parameters for that tree. You can give the name to that tree, okay, if you can set. Okay, so here now normally we are using a binary tree. If you are aware of the this thing, categorization of the data just by using if then else condition, okay, so say for example you are having data, you are writing the condition, if the value is less than this, okay, then categorize like this. If value is greater than this, then again further go to next level, and then again check if the other feature like age is less than this, then do the categorization like this. Okay, so say for example in a class 60 students are there, so you want to do a categorization. So first you are doing the categorization based on gender. So if you are telling if gender is equal to male, then this category, otherwise this category. Then again in that you will be dividing whether the students who have taken NSS or not, maybe the students who have taken the elective subject as this or not, maybe the students who are of age below 19 or not. So likewise you are having different conditions, and based on that condition you will be generating the tree structure. So here basically we are using a binary tree, okay, and here how many leaves that tree can have, that also you can put over here, okay. You can also set the number of levels in that tree. Okay, so all these parameters can be set over here. So for time being, I'm just keeping this by default. You can change it and you can see it. Now, when you want to see that, you can just use Tree Viewer and click this. So now, if you can see, the whole data set is now being shown as a tree structure. So if you can see, now we are having three classes in that iris data: iris setosa, iris versicolor, and iris virginica. Okay, so now they're just taking your petal length as a feature,
if petal length is less than or equal to 1.9, then this is one categorization. If it is greater than 1.9, then this. Okay. Again, in this, they are taking petal width. If petal width is less than or equal to 1.7, then this. If greater than this, then this. Again, in this, they are doing the same thing. And this will continue. Okay. So likewise, it is just building a tree and showing you in a tree format. So those who are actually familiar with the data mining and all, so if you are familiar with decision tree algorithm, okay, so this is nothing but a decision tree algorithm only. Okay, you are just applying if then else rule and you are just dividing or categorizing the data into different categories. Okay, so this is the tool which is used for visualization of that tree. Now suppose I am changing the data, so let me change to zoo. Okay, and let's see. Same thing, just I have changed the data set and now you can see the tree. Okay, so let me just show you. The tree is little bit, because so many features are there. Okay, so you can see here. Okay, so in mammal, if we are taken the feature as milk, okay, the animals who are in mammal and giving or producing milk, okay, if the value is zero, they are categorized as bird. Okay, if value is one, means they are producing milk, so they are mammal. Okay, likewise again, bird may, if feathers we have taken, okay, if no feathers means zero value, then they are fish. Okay, if one value, then bird. Likewise, the categorization is done and you'll be getting the various classes over here. Okay, and whatever the leaves you are getting, okay, so you can see mammal, then bird, then fish, then amphibian, then reptile, then invertebrate, then insects, and this, these are nothing but the classes in that particular data set. So in this way, you can actually categorize the data by using simple if then else rule, okay, and it can be visualized. Okay, so that is the visualization which you can do with the help of tree. Okay, now coming to the next visualization, which is very important, okay, and that is called as nomogram. Okay, so actually this nomogram is the visualization which is used for the classification result, and it is showing you the visualization of the spatialized classification algorithm, like the logistic regression or naive-Bayes algorithm. So if you are aware about naive-Bayes, it is purely based on probability theory. Okay, so based on that, we are going to classify, or we are going to classify the data and we are getting the output. So just let me demonstrate you with that. Okay, so that you can see, I'll just have the image also so that you can see how it is looking like. And if you want to do along with me, you can do that. Yeah, so this is the image for nomogram. So what I'll be doing, I'll be taking file first, and here, say for example, now I just take the other data set. Let me just take Titanic data set. Okay. Now our normal practice, you can see the data by using data table. So this is the data table where here this is the data related to Titanic. Okay, and here we are having only this three attributes, that is status, age, and sex. Okay, and we are classifying that whether they survived, okay, or they are not survived. So here this particular survived, S value means they are survived, and no means they are not survived. Okay, so likewise we are having total 2201 record. Okay, and these features are status, age, and sex. Okay, now let's see how it is happening. So now what I did here, if you can see the image, let me just zoom it so that you can see. Yeah. So now what I did, whatever the file I have, okay, I have a data table, I have displayed it. Now I'm just using here naive-Bayes classifier, okay, to classify this data. So now what I did, I just use here naive-Bayes. Okay, and here this widget comes. So now when I click on this naive-Bayes, you can see that we can just give the name to that. Okay, and automatically the settings are there, predefined settings are there. So it is just calculating the probabilities, and based on that, it is classifying the data which is coming to this. Now, if you want to visualize this, okay, you can visualize by using this nomogram. So how to do it? Okay. So here, just let me select here nomogram. Okay. And now here you can see here model to classifier. And now this, whatever thing you are seeing, you can just click on this, double click on this channel, and you can see that the output of new base, this is the model, and the output of this model will be actually given to the classifier input of the nomogram. So it is showing you what part is taken from this as an output and what part is taken as a input. So that will shown over here when you click on this. So you can just click on every channel and see. Okay, so from file data will be taken and it will go to data of this data table. Similarly, here you can see the data will be taken from this file and it will go to the data section of this particular naive base widget. So likewise, you can click and you can see. Now, when I want to show this nomogram, okay, here I have to pass my data also. So I'll be passing my data over here. Okay. Now here, as again, it is the dotted line is appearing. So I need to select the data. So now what I'll be doing, for time being, I am selecting everything. So now this is coming. And when I click on this, okay, you can see. So you can see over here, this is showing you the probability of that particular, because the naive Bayes algorithm is actually based on the probabilities only. So it is showing you probabilities. Okay. And here it is showing you that three attributes are there: age, status, and sex. Okay. And this is the zero value. And now we are having the range of the probability. So you can see over here, it's showing you the total probabilities percentage. Okay. And this, and here you can see, this is survived as no. Okay. Where you are getting probability as 53%. And likewise, you can actually see the nomogram, and mostly this particular thing is used to show the output when the classifier is based on probability. Okay. Again, there is one more algorithm called as logistic regression. So let me just show you that also with this. So let me select it. So I'm selecting here logistic regression. And I'm passing this. Okay, so it is showing me model to classifier, and just, yeah. Okay. I'll use another nomogram over here. Okay. And now when I click this, okay, it is showing me the this probability for the logistic regression. Okay, so now for logistic regression, if you see for both, if I click this naive base, this is the probability, and this is for logistic regression. So you can find out in what way they are actually working in different way. So here, if you can see over here, the range of the probabilities, okay, or the range, the total probabilities are changing over here. This particular is changing over here. So earlier it was present some more over here. Okay, now it is present some more over here. Okay. And so likewise, depending on the algorithm, you will be getting different values in nomogram. So let me go to logistic regression. And here in logistic regression, if you can see, there are various parameters which we can control. Okay. So what are those parameters? So we can observe actually that in logistic regression, basically the model is working based on what kind of regularization you are using. Okay, so if you can see over here, the regularization type we can select, and here we are having two regularization available over here. That is the normal lasso model and the ridge model. Okay, so they are also called as the L1, L2, and these are the most popular, popularly used regularization types. Of course, if you want to use your own regularization type, then you need to write some Python coding and you need to put over here, so that instead of using this two inbuilt regularization type, some other type can also be used. Okay, and here it is assumed that the cost strength for this particular regularization type is always used as one. Okay, and you can select, so currently it is, if you can see over here, it is ridge. Okay, you can select the this thing, and if you can see, strength is now selected as one. You can change the strength, and of course by changing it you can observe the difference in the value. So I'll just show you when I'll be showing you the classification, okay, that how this value will actually affect the accuracy of the algorithm. So currently I'm just putting this as one only. Yeah, and here the ridge is used, and accordingly you will be getting the value. And now if suppose, you want to put it as a chart, sorry, not a line chart, sorry for this. It is not capable to produce the, I just wanted to see, show you the this thing, the probabilities in particular column, but it is not allowing me to create a data table. But anyways, you can see the probabilities over here, okay, and you can find out how it is working. And for different data set, again, it is different depending on what kind of model you are, sorry, regularization type you are selecting. Again, it is changing. Okay, so that is the nomogram. Okay, there is one more feature, one more plot which is used in most of the data analytics, and that is Venn diagram. Okay, so normally we are using Venn diagram to show the show as a subset distribution, and how the sets are actually, whether they are distinct or they are having some intersections and all, that we are showing. But here in analytics also we can show that. So I'll just take some case study, and along with that I'll show you Venn diagram, then it will be more clear. Okay, so this is all for the plots. Okay, different plots which you can use, and see, there are different, again, different plots available. Like line plot is a simple plot which is used to show the line. Okay, then we are having bar plot, then this we are having CU diagram. So again, based on probabilities and all, we are having the CU diagram and mosaic display. Okay, then we are having the this thing, visualization tool called as linear projection. So this is actually showing you the projected at the values of the attributes on the projected axis. Okay, same way you can use here the Pythagorean tree. So if you are working with some tree-based algorithm, so there you can use this Pythagorean tree. So depending on the application and depending on how you want to represent those, you can use the particular tool. Okay, so if suppose you are using a random forest algorithm, and if you want to visualize those, so then you can use this Pythagorean forest. Okay, so this is just extension of Pythagorean tree, so that can be used. Okay, and a nomogram already we have seen. The silhouettes plot is again one of the visualization which is showing you the silhouette score. Okay, so I'll be showing you that in the next this thing. Okay, that how it is calculated, and then we'll see how it is plotted. Okay, so there are different visualizations available in orange. So depending on what kind of application you are working and what kind of analysis you want to visually represent,
you can use, you can select the appropriate visualization, because we cannot just make a general statement that we can use all visualization for all types of data. Depending on what data you are having in hand, depending on again what kind of analysis you are doing, okay, one has to carefully select the visualization. Okay, otherwise, in some cases, it will not show you visualization of those analytics, or some of the visualization is only for specific kind of data, so that cannot be used for the other kind of data. Okay, so that's the way which you can use. So I guess you can explore these things, okay, by taking different data and just see how it can be visualized. Okay, so that is the visualization tool. Now I'll be taking a simple case studies to show you. Sorry for this. So first, I'll be showing you the I just wanted to show you the Silhouette score and all. So that's why I'm taking this case study. So let me show you how the hierarchical clustering is done. Okay. So basically, the clustering is the unsupervised learning where we are going to classify the data into different categories, okay, based on the similarities of the samples or similarities of the values of those features. So for that, basically, we are calculating some distance measures, and based on those distance measures value, we are just going to combine those features together, and they are making the cluster. Or we are taking one centroid, and from that centroid, we are just taking the distance of all the samples, and whichever are in the particular threshold, we are calling, or we are actually taking them as a part of that particular cluster. And in this way, the whole data is being divided into multiple clusters or multiple categories. Okay, so that is the normal way by which the clustering is working. Okay, so if you are aware of k-means clustering, let me first take that, okay, so that you can have an idea. So this is k-means. Okay, so just I'll be showing you with the help of the schematic, so it will be easier for you to understand. Okay, so now if you can see over here, okay, there are two ways by which I can use k-means. Okay, one is I can take a data in the file and I can apply the k-means, or I can create my own data and then I can apply the k-means. So I'll be showing you by both way, but as we already started with the simple file, so let me just take this file. So I am using here again, I go back to my iris data, okay, and now I am just selecting my algorithm as k-means. Yeah, so k-means is selected. Now, if you can see over here in this visualization, now k-means algorithm is applied. So you can click on this, and now you can control this by simply putting the value. Okay. Hello. Yeah. So here you have an option whether you want to categorize the data into fixed number of clusters, okay, or if you want to categorize the data into dynamic number of clusters, okay? So say here fixed number of clusters. So I want to categorize the data into fixed 3 cluster. So let me just demonstrate you this, and then we'll see this next one, okay? Now here, some initialization has been done over here that the rerun will be done every 10, this thing, and the maximum iterations are 300. So you can change this values, no worry. Okay, and you can see the result. So now just simply I have used here that I want to categorize this data, or I want to divide this data into 3 clusters. Okay, so that I have done. Okay, now you can see that now whatever data is coming from this file, that will be taken as input. The clustering will be performed and the data is divided or categorized into 3 clusters. Now to visualize this, I can use the scatter plot. Scatter plot is the best visualization tool, okay, to see the result of classification, okay, or clustering. So now I just put here scatter plot, and when I click on this, you can see now as I have divided, I have just set here, I want to divide this into 3 clusters. So if you can see over here, okay, the whole data is divided or categorized into three clusters. Okay, iris setosa, which is shown in blue color, iris versicolor, which is in red color, and iris virginica, which is in green color. Okay, and if you want to show this thing, you can just control it and by using this. So I just want to show you the this thing. So just I made here color region. So now you can see here this blue region is the samples which corresponds to this iris setosa. This red region, okay, this is the region where we are having the samples as iris versicolor, and here these are the this is the region which is having iris virginica. But if you can see over here, okay, in this particular green zone, you can see some of the red samples are appearing, and in this red zone again some of the green samples are appearing. So actually this is not the correct clustering of the data, because we have fixed it that we want to divide the whole data into three different clusters. That's why it is trying to classify it into three clusters, and due to that here it is lots of misclassification is happening. So this green sample should be present in this area, but now it is coming to this. Okay, so now that's why here, instead of using the fixed number of clusters, okay, one should go for dynamic number of cluster. Okay, so once when I have used here dynamic number of clusters, so I just gave a range, okay, that 2 to 8. See, so 2 to 8, any number of clusters can be used. So now if you can see over here, okay, what it is doing, it is just trying to divide that data, trying to categorize the data into different clusters. So first it will try to divide that, it will try to categorize that into two clusters, and it is calculating a score called as Sillod score. So this Sillod score is actually showing you the value. So if it is towards 1, that shows the higher value, and if it is towards 0, it shows the lower value. So if higher the values, it shows how close that samples are to that particular cluster. Okay, so always if we are here we are given the range 2 to 8, so for number of two clusters it is giving me Sillod score as 0.580. if the three cluster has to be made, it is giving me the value as 0.459. okay, and so on. And now if you can see, when I just come from this fixed to dynamic, okay, it is automatically calculating the Sillod score, and it is giving me the best value. It is giving me the best value, and if you can see, it is highlighted by blue color. So the best prediction, which the algorithm has made, that only in two cluster this has to be divided, so that such kind of interference is not there, and all the samples will be categorized in particular category. And it is shown that Sillod score is, so whichever is having highest Sillod score, that is the best prediction of number of cluster. So here 2 is the best prediction of number of cluster, and now let's see the output. So sorry for this. So now here I have used here clusters. Earlier also I should have used it, but okay. So now I have used here this cluster, and if you can see, now it is dividing this into only two clusters. Okay, one is shown as blue color and one is shown as red color. And if you see all the samples, okay, with blue color are in this area only, and all the samples and in red color are in this area only. There is no outlier, or there is no interference. Okay, like just let me show you the previous output also. I'll just make it fixed. Yeah, so I just make it fixed, and I just wanted to show you this thing, but still some outliers are there. Some green are going to this region and some blue are coming to this region, so it is not appropriate clustering. But now I change it, and I just made it as this, and this is selected, number of clusters will be 2. And now if I can plot it, I can see this. So in this way, k-means can be used for clustering. Okay, so and if you want to again have a scatter plot, okay, the scatter plot is already shown. If you want to show box plot, you can see the box plot and you can see the values over here. So already we have seen how the values are shown in this. Okay, you can select. So for cluster, it is not showing like this. Yeah. So this is for siloed. Okay, this is for sepal length, sepal width. For every feature, you can see the values over here. So we have seen that already it is showing you mean, median, and standard deviation and all. So, and also it is showing you the minimum and maximum, okay, for every this thing. Okay. So in this way, you can have a box plot. Also, there is one more this thing called as a multi. Yeah. So let me just show you. So here, actually, this MDS is showing you the visualization in terms of the connectivity between this. So I'm just showing you the clusters. Okay. So it is showing you the connectivity between the various samples within that clusters. Okay. And of course, there are distances within the threshold, and that's why they are in one cluster, and here they are in another cluster. So in this way, you can see the visualization by using MDS visualization also. So this is how you can use k-means, okay, for the data which is coming from some of the file. Now, if you want to create your own data, what you can do, you can use here somewhere, yeah, this paint data tool is there. So you can just click on this paint data tool. So it will show you this particular screen. Okay, so you are having X and Y and this empty, this thing is there. If you can just click over here and you can create your own samples. So I'm just creating here my own samples over here. Just, and I'll be putting some random samples here and there. Okay. So I have painted this data, close it. Now pass it to k-means. Okay. And then perform the scatter plot. Now here again, you can have fixed number of clusters. So when you are having fixed number of clusters, you can see over here. So now as we are having only X and Y, it is showing me like this, okay? And here I'm taking clusters. So earlier I have three clusters and it is showing me like this, okay? So it is doing the categorization. Now when I simply do here from this thing, dynamic. So now it is giving me that if I can divide this data into 5 cluster, okay, then it will be better and I'll be getting the siloed score as 0.391, which is highest among this range from 2 to 8. So now let's see here. These are the clusters done. So you can see over here, these 5 clusters are seen over here. So in this way, you can do the, you can apply the clustering and see how you can simply classify the data or categorize the data into various clusters. Okay, so this is the k-means algorithm. Now coming to the next, that is hierarchical clustering. So hierarchical clustering is mostly that is based on the distance which is calculated between the samples. Okay, so now again I'll be taking here file. Okay, now first we need to calculate a distance, so that's why here you have to take a distance. And you can see over here, this distance widget is actually used to calculate the distance between various features. Okay. So what kind of distances are there? So there are n number of different distances available. Most popular or most simple distance is Euclidean distance. So many people are using that distance. But when you come to machine learning literature, there are other distances which are proved to be very good while dealing with the accuracy of the algorithm rather than the Euclidean distances. Okay, so here also we are having some inbuilt distances in orange. So you might be aware of all these distances as you are from the mathematics domain. Okay, so there are Manhattan distance, cosine distance, Jacquard distance, then the Spearman distance, then absolute Spearman, then Pearson, then Hamming, then Mahalanobis, and few more, Bhattacharya distance. Okay, so likewise, different distances are there. Okay, and these are playing important role in the accuracy of the algorithm. So as most of the people are using Euclidean distance, but if you see in literature, there are a few instances where if you can use Mahal Nobis or Bhattacharya or Jacquard distance, the output which you are getting will be more better, or it is more accurate than what you are getting with the Euclidean distance. Okay, so depending on that, means you can use this kind of distances. So this facility is available in Orange. You can use different distances and see how it is actually working. Okay, now once you have that, then you can actually use the hierarchical clustering. So this is the hierarchical clustering, and if you can see over here, it is showing you now based depending on the distances, it is simply trying to show you a dendrogram, okay, of all the classes. So it is showing you like this, if you can see, okay, the complete dendrogram is calculated based on the distances, okay, and you'll be getting the classes over here. So you can see the classes over here, and now if suppose you want to plot it, okay, if you want to plot it, simply I'll just zoom it so that you can see. So I just put the hierarchical clustering. If you want to see that into tabular format, then you can use a data table. But now here, whole thing, if you want to see specific part, you just click on it, just shift and click on it. Yeah, so I have selected this. And if you can put here data table, only that selected things are made available over here. Okay, so if you can see over here, automatically clustering is done. And you can see we are having C1, C2, C3, C4, C5. Five clusters are made. Okay, so it is showing me that. If I want to select the complete data, then I can select the whole thing. I'll just put here the whole thing I have selected. And now I am going over here. So it is showing me like only one cluster I am having because I have selected everything in one shot only. So it is showing me whole thing as one, this thing. Okay. And now if I'm selecting like this, this is one. Okay. So it is showing C1. Then this is second. This is C2. This is C3. Then like this is this particular level C4. And then I can see over here. Okay, and if you want to visualize this, okay, you can actually use the scatter plot. So what I'll be doing, I'm just putting here in scatter plot. So you can see, I'll just make a clusters over here. So if you can see over here, it is showing me in these 7 clusters. Okay, so likewise, it is showing me all the clusters, whichever, and it depends on what data, what dendrogram you have selected. Okay. If you are selecting here, if I'm selecting here, maybe this thing. So this will change. If you can see over here, now it might have changed. I'll just make it smaller. Yeah. So now only 6 cluster. Earlier it was 7. Now it is showing 6 cluster. So in this way you can see. And if you want to see your original data also, just let me close. This I have already selected. If you want to see the selected clustering data as well as your original data in the scatter plot, okay, just take the data from file and pass it to scatter plot. So what will happen in the scatter plot, it will put original data as well as it will put selected data. So you can see over here. Okay. Some problem. So it should be selected data to data subset. Okay. Yeah, I need to select here this thing. like this, and yeah, so it is showing me the data. And now, yeah, so here I have probably selected. I'll just remove it one more time, and I'll just select few samples. Okay, and now I am plotting it. So yeah, now it is, you can see that here I'll be, I have taken whole data. So the whole data is shown like this, and only this C1 and C2 cluster, which I have selected, that will be shown over here. And this is nothing but the other data, which is present over there, but I am not, I have not selected it. So it is showing me other data, whereas these are the data which I have highlighted. So likewise, it is actually giving you the hierarchical clustering output. Okay, and you can visualize that by using the scatter plot. Also, you can see that in the data table also. So only this data I have selected. So you can see only two clusters are there, C1 and C2. Okay, that's why if you go in scatter plot, it is showing you only C1 and C2, and rest of the samples are not taken into consideration, and they will fall in other category. Okay, so in this way, you can just make the thing. Of course, here if you are selecting different data, okay, and if you are putting here, so one way is what you can do. You can go to hierarchical clustering, select some data, and you just make on the channel, you make selected data to data subset, take the data from files. So instead of others, it will show you me the data from files, and the selected data means whatever output I'm getting, same output I'll be getting. Okay, only thing is now this other will be my actual data, and this C1 and C2 is my output of my hierarchical clustering. So in this way, actually, you can see the output of this particular algorithm. Okay, in this. Now, one more thing is, one can ask the question that whatever data I am getting in this data table, okay, can I reuse that data? Okay, so of course, here you can reuse that data. Okay, so here, if you can see here, when I click on this. You can see the options over here. This is save option, okay? And it is showing me the features of that. So when you click on save option, okay, it is asking, it is actually allowing you to save. So you can save this as one tab, table, and you can reuse in some of the other experiments, okay? So if you're performing some experimentation where you are clustering the data, and you are simply making them, representing them into different categories by using this data table. So you can save it and you can use it for your further experimentation also. So that facility is also available in Orange. Okay, so that one can actually do. Now coming to a very important feature of Orange. Okay, because mostly this particular software is used by the people who are working in machine learning community, okay, to actually get the complete analysis to be done on the data which they are giving, as well as to find out various evaluation, or we can say the assessment parameters of those particular machine learning models. Okay, so normally when we use machine learning, we are using it for classification of the data. Okay, the problem of classification is handled by using all these learning algorithms, and it is very important to find out the parameters, evaluation parameters, like what accuracy we are getting. Okay, then what is the precision and recall we are getting, and what is the F1 score we are getting. So normally we know that F1 score, mostly it depends, the precision, recall, and F1 score, these are the parameter which are calculated from true positive and true negatives, which are resulted out from this learning. And based on that, you'll be calculating this. And accuracy is also calculated, and you can actually see what kind of accuracy you are getting. Okay, and more the accuracy, the number of, or the result of classification is better, means number of misclassifications are less. Okay, so that is the main what we can say, that is the purpose why the people who are working in machine learning domain are using this kind of tools. Okay, so that they can get the analysis done simply by using drag and drop things. of course, if they want to write some coding, they can always put the coding along with this orange. So now I'll be showing you that thing also first, and then after that, I'll be showing you some of the other features which explore further later on. Yeah, so let me just show you this thing. I'll just take one this thing, and then I'll show you the rest of the things. So first of all, what I'll be doing, I'll be taking a file. Okay. Now here, what we can do that whenever we are actually using any machine learning algorithm, so they are actually called as learning models. Okay, we are referring them as learning model. Okay, and of course we have to validate or we have to evaluate the learning in terms of some assessments. Okay, so that can be done by using the this thing. The tools like wizards like test and score and confusion matrix. So confusion matrix is giving you the classification classification matrix where it is showing you whether whether how much is the classification, how much is the accuracy in the classification, or if any misclassification is there or not. Okay, so there are two different ways to do this. I'll show you both the ways. Okay. So very first way, already we have done with Naive Bayes. So I'm showing you with Naive Bayes only. Okay. So I'm using here Naive Bayes as a learning model. And now I have passed this data to it. So I'm using here again, same iris tab I have earlier selected. So same is selected over here. Now this is the learning model which I have selected, but now I need to do certain assessment. So I'll be using here test and score. So if you can see over here, this test score is nothing but it is giving us the output in terms of prediction, okay, and evaluation results. So if you can click over here, select this. So now here I'll be using here test and score, and I'll pass this. Okay. So now what it is doing, same thing I have just shown in different way. So this is taking this as learning model, this as the input data. Okay. This is nothing but your training data to that model. And now it is just taking this model, the learning model. This is the training data. So the data will be taken into consideration and model is trained. And now you will be getting the assessment of that. Okay. So if you can see over here, when you click on test and score, okay, it is giving you the evaluation results. So if you can see, when I hover my mouse over here, you might have seen, it is giving me the output in terms of prediction and evaluation result. So now this is nothing but my evaluation result. Okay. So if you can see over here, the Naive Bayes, it is giving me the area under curve as 0.98, okay, and it is giving me the classification accuracy as 0.87, okay. The F1 score is 0.873. The precision and recall is 0.87 and 0.87. So depending on precision and recall, this F1 score is calculated. So it is nothing but a harmonic mean of this, okay. So you can see here for this particular data set, the classification accuracy is 0.873 for Naive Bayes. Okay, now let me just select here some other data instead of iris. Suppose I have a zoo data. Okay, and same model is run. So if you can see over here, in earlier case, the accuracy was different. If you have noted that for iris data, the accuracy was 0.873. And now I have changed my data. And the data is now the Titanic data. So now you can see the classification accuracy is different. Okay. So likewise here, you can simply change your data set and see what kind of classification accuracy you are getting. Okay. of course, here when this testing and score testing evaluation is done, okay, some of the control parameters are very important. So if you can see over here, it is performing a cross validation, and for performing that cross validation, how many number of folds are used. So here inbuilt values are given over here, like 2-fold, 3-fold, 5-fold, and all this thing. So based on the number of folds you are using, your result will also change. Okay, so one need to be very cautious when selecting this. Okay, and the default values are the best possible values which are actually set over there. But if you want to change it, you can change and try it. Okay, if you want to use some random sampling and all, you can also use over here. So normally here the 66% of the data is used for training and rest of the data is used for testing. If you want to change this, you can also change it. Okay. Here normally the model comparison here, you can actually do based on this particular parameters. Okay. So by default it is put as area under ROC curve, or you can put like F1 score or any other thing. Okay. So that is not a problem. Okay. So here mostly the comparison is shown over here. Okay. But now currently here we have seen area under curve. So now let me just take one more classifier. So I'll be taking here classifier as maybe random forest. I'm taking the second classifier as random forest. So just what you can do, this thing will remain same. Okay, just you pass this learner to this. So what it does, it take this data and it will just take this learning model, and the model will be learned, okay, or model will be trained by using this data, and the result will be ready to use over here. Okay, so when you click on this, now as both the models we have used, so it is showing me the result of both models. So for naive Bayes already we have seen these are the parameters. So for random forest is showing me. So if you can see the classification accuracy of naive Bayes and random forest, it is showing, and it is little bit improved in random forest than naive Bayes. Okay, now let me take one more, that is neural network. And now I'm just doing same. So it is now doing the evaluation. Yeah. So testing is the samples are taken, training happened, and we got the output. So if you can see over here, now I'll be getting the output. Okay. And if you can see over here, this is naive Bayes, random forest, and neural network. So if you can see, the neural network and random forest both are getting same accuracy. Okay. And here the model comparison by AUC is done. Okay, so if you can see over here, it is just giving you the what we can say, the tabular format. So here it is giving you the model comparison by using AUC among these three models. Okay, so if you can observe over here, now up till now we have seen that these two are giving us the best result. Now let's try out one more. I'm using now logistic regression. The fourth one I'm using logistic regression. So just pass it to this. Okay. And now see the output. So the logistic regression is giving me 7, 7, 8. Okay. So still random forest, and this is giving me this thing. Let me try some more. I'll be using AdaBoost. So I'm not going into detail of this, just to show you this logistic regression already we have seen. In random forest, you can again set the thing, number of trees kitna hoga, and the limit of depth and all that you can set. Okay. Similarly, neural network, there are lot many parameters which you can set. Okay, that how many neurons should be there in hidden layer. So default value is 100. You can change it. What activation function has to be used? So default is ReLU, which is one of the popular. Likewise, you can have identity, logistic, or sigmoid, that is TANH. Also, which kind of optimization algorithm is used. So these are popular algorithms like Adams or the gradient descent and this thing. So Adam is used over here. And you can select the regularization also, and the number of epoch which you want to use. So that has to be selected over here, and you will be getting the things are run, okay, by using those parameters. So now I have used your AdaBoost and added over here. Okay, now let's see the comparison. So here, if you can see, the AdaBoost is again having 0.788. So almost they are having similar kind of this thing. Now let me change the data set. I'll be changing this to Iris. Now again, one more time, it is doing for all the models and it is showing me the result. Now, if you can see over here, now random forest is giving me 0.95. Logistic regression is giving me 0.96. So this is the model which is giving me the highest accuracy for this particular IRIS data. Okay. Now, after doing this, you can actually see how many classification and misclassification happened. Okay. So for that, the confusion matrix is generated. So if you can see, now for naive Bayes, so select whichever classifier you want to see. So if you click on naive Bayes, it is showing you the classification matrix. So if you can see over here, this particular out of 150 samples, okay, you can see 19 misclassifications are there. These are showing you the correct classification, whereas these are the misclassification. So if you can see, the 8 samples which should be actually in the Iris virginica, but they get classified as Iris versicolor. Similarly, 11 sample, they should be actually in versicolor, but they get classified as virginica. So this 9 misclassifications are there. If you want to see those misclassification ki kahan pe ho raha hai, you can select misclassified, okay, and you can just have a data table. So you can see here, these are the misclassified thing. Okay, so you can see 19 samples, these are misclassified. Okay, so they should be versicolor, but they classified as virginica. This should be virginica, but it classified as versicolor and all. So the complete analysis of misclassification you can find out. Similarly, if you want to see the confusion matrix for random forest, you can see. So number of misclassifications are less in random forest. Only 7 misclassifications are there. In neural network, again, 7 misclassifications are there. In logistic regression, see, the number of misclassifications are very less. These are only 5. So if you can observe, the number of misclassifications are less and accuracy is also more in logistic regression. In AdaBoost, 7. So if you can see here, we are having here 19, 7, 7, 5, and 7. Okay. And if you can see the accuracy, okay, the logistic regression is having higher accuracy as misclassifications are less. Okay. So likewise, you can actually see, and now you can have a data table to see that. So now what I did, I just did this 4 and 3. Now I'll use logistic regression and I select misclassified. So when I click on this, it will show me only the misclassified or samples of logistic regression. They are 5. Okay. Now I was mentioning you about the Venn diagram. So let me just show you about this. Yeah. How Venn diagram can be used. So I have just. Yeah. So now what I did, I have used this many things. Okay. Now what I'll be doing here, I'll be generating different confusion. So here I have selected, this is the confusion matrix for naive Bayes. Okay. Then I'm generating one more confusion matrix, and this is the confusion matrix of random forest. Then I'm generating one more confusion matrix. This is the confusion matrix for neural network. Then one more. This is for logistic regression. And one more I'll be selecting. And this is for the last one, that is AdaBoost. Okay. And now what I'll be doing, I'll be just selecting misclassified. So I need to go to this and select misclassified. Again, I need to go and select misclassified. I have selected all misclassified. Yeah. So now I got all misclassified. And if I want to see the Venn diagram representation, so now what I have to do, I have to just click here. I'll be using here Venn diagram. And now simply I'm connecting this. So all the misclassifying, this thing will be given to this from this. from this. Yellow shows warning, so we can just neglect it. Yeah. When I click this, we know that in the first one, okay, that is the nav base here. 19 misclassifications are there, then 7, then 7, then 5 and 7. Okay. So now if you click on this and see, so here you can see actually the complete Venn diagram, and it is showing you the result like this. So if you can see, it is showing you 19 is a misclassification for logistic regression. You can see over here. Okay. So it is showing you the complete properties of that. Nav base mean 19 misclassification, random forest 7. Neural network 8, logistic regression 5, and Adabus 7. Okay. And when you actually perform the, it is taking all those things, misclassification into consideration, and it will just try to create a Venn diagram. And if you can see these four features, okay, these four features are the common misclassified features in every classifier. Okay. So that thing you can see over here. Okay. And now from this, let me see whether I can show you the data table. Yeah. So it is showing me the complete data table, but as such here from table, it is not significantly visible, but you can see over here itself, okay, that it is trying to use 1, 2, 3, 4, 5 different sets are there. Okay. And it's just trying to show you the Venn diagram. And these are the four common features, okay, which are actually there in every misclassification result. Okay. So in this way, Venn diagram can also be useful in showing the results. Okay. So I hope you have got the gist of this. Okay. Madam, I have. Do you have? Do you want me to continue further, or I need to stop here?
Ma'am, you can go take for another 5 minutes. Then we'll take question and answers if they have.
Okay, because I just wanted to take some of the this thing. Just take one or two case studies from time series and image analytics, so that they will.
I think you should continue.
Yeah. So let me just go to time series. So in this way you can take. So I just took here some of the learning models, but if you can see, there are many learning models available. Okay. This is in supervised, and in unsupervised also many learning models are available. So you can use that learning models and you can see how they're working. Okay. So as you are from statistic field, if you want to simply use some other models along with this, okay, so you can use those by incorporating Python script, or if you are pretty comfortable with this particular parameters, you can use this parameters and you can come up with some research publication by doing certain kind of analysis on the real world data if you are having that in your hand. Okay, so this is about the machine learning models. Okay. Now, let me quickly show you the time series analysis. Okay, so I'll be just showing you this. So for time series, we can go to the time series. And now here you can download the data from internet. So if you can see over here, this is Yahoo Finance data. So I'm taking this data. Okay. Now, here as it is inbuilt, okay, I have taken this. You can take the data by using this widgets also, no problem. So here, when you click on this Yahoo Finance, okay, it is allowing you to take this Yahoo Finance stock data from various sites. Okay, so the ticker which are used over here are Google, Amazon, Facebook, and other things. Okay, so from whichever thing, suppose I want to use from Google, and what kind of data means for what particular duration of time you want to get that data, you can select. So say, for example, here I have selected 1st January 2021 to today's date. Okay, maybe 22nd I have selected. So for this, I want the data. So just click on download, and the data is now downloaded and available for your use. Okay. So I have just taken the data of 21 days. You can select just timeline over here, and that data can be downloaded.
Okay, so now I have that Yahoo Finance data with me. Okay, now what I can do, if you can see over here in this, there are various models available. So this VAR model and ARIMA model, these are the very popular model, okay, which are available for the prediction in time series. Okay, so say for example, I am using VAR, VAR model. So let me select VAR model over here. Okay, so I have selected VAR model, and to show the this thing, the plot of this, now we have to use the tool called as line chart. Okay, so if you can see over here, we are having a line chart tool. Okay, so that can be used over here. So you can use the line chart. So click on this. You can simply use the forecast to forecast. Just forecast to forecast. Okay, and now you have to pass your original data also to this line chart. Okay, and this is time series to time series. Okay, so now when you're clicking on this, we are using VAR model, and if you can see again here, you are having some parameters which you can set over here for the VAR model. So again, it is using some kind of regression. So you can select here the order of that regression. Okay, you can again select some optimization parameters. Okay, so here there are various optimization parameters available. One can select. So here, for example, nothing is select currently. Okay, then the trained vector also you are you can select. So depending on what kind of analysis you are doing, so maybe you can select. Currently it is none, but you can select a constant or maybe linear or maybe combination of linear, quadratic, and all those things. Okay, and the forecasting steps ahead also you can change the value over here. Okay, so that particular thing will be taken into consideration and forecasting will be done. Okay, so if you can see over here now, some kind of annotation is happening. Can you just ask to erase it?
Yes, I'll erase the annotations. Just a second.
So if you can see over here, these are the various parameters which are there in this finance data. So if you can take here high, low, open, close, volume, and this adjacent close, this parameter. So if you see the time series, okay, we have taken the data from 1st January and till yesterday, okay, 22nd. So if you can see, this is showing me the data, okay, and this is the thick line is showing me the data till today. And if you can see the dotted line, okay, this dotted line is nothing but it's a forecast value. Okay, so now here VAR model is used, and this is this dotted line is showing you the forecasted value. So from the 22nd, because the data is still 22nd, so from 22nd onward, it is just forecasting the value and showing me the forecast. Okay, so same way it is showing for low, for open, for close, for volume, and for adjacent close. Okay, so likewise you can see the forecasting over here in the time series. So mostly for stock prediction data. Okay, so if you are having the data in your hand, you can just give it to this model and you will be getting the forecasting of that. Okay, so now let me use some other model. So yeah, so I'll be using here ARIMA model, which is very famous model in forecasting. So here I'm using time series to time series. And again here, now I'll be using another chart. Forecast to forecast. And I'll be passing this to this again. And now you can see. So if you can see over here, if I'm taking here this high, so actually here the ARIMA model is giving me the forecasting this. So if you can see here, this dotted line is nothing but this is the forecasted value. So you can just find out what can be the forecast of this particular. So if at 22nd January, okay, this is the value. So what will be the forecasted value and all, you can see at different this thing. Time and day. Okay, So in this way, time series analysis can be used. Okay. You can also have the model evaluation similar to the machine learning. Okay, here also different models are there. So you can do the model evaluation of that and you can find out how it can be done. Okay. So I guess these two things you can just try out by different data and you can just explore how it can be done. Okay. So now I'll be taking the next. I'll be just showing you image analytics. Yeah, so this will be the, just to give you the feel of how it can be used, okay? So now I'll be just clearing my workspace, okay? And I'll go to the image analytics, okay? Now first I have to import the images, okay? So now here I'll be just clicking on this and I have to import the images. So what I did, I have already, now this image data set is not available in Orange. So I have downloaded it and I have put in the folder. So I'll be just going to that folder and here I have put, yeah, this domestic animal. This is my folder which I have selected. So this data is now uploaded. So 19 images are there. Okay. Now, if you want to see this in data table, you can see, okay, that this particular, yeah. So I'll just show you that folder also so that you can get an idea. So these are the images which are there in my folder, okay? And you can see all these are domestic animals, okay? All these are domestic animals. So now what we'll be doing, okay? I have just taken that, loaded into the workspace. If I just wanted to show you, like I'm getting the image size and the various parameters about it, like size, width and height and all those things. But actually these are not important from the point of view of classification. Okay, we need to extract some features from that image. Okay, so now for that we have to use one widget called as image embedding. So this image embedding is a tool which is actually trying to get some statistical parameters or features from those images, and that will be made available for further usage. So now what I have to do, I have to pass all these images to this image embedding. So this image embedding will be giving me all the features, okay, extracted features over here. So the output of this, whatever to whichever widget I'll be connecting this, all the features will be passed to this. And now you can use our normal machine learning. So I'm just using here logistic regression. Okay, anything, any one, this thing you can use. So I'm using here logistic regression. I'm using here test and score. And I'm passing this logistic regression learner to this, and I'm passing these features to this. Okay. Some problems there. Yeah, actually it is taking time to do that. So once it is done, okay, this test and score, like our normal procedure, okay, and here you can have, let me just complete the procedure by that time, confusion matrix. And then to view the result, now we cannot use any plot or this, we have, because the result is in terms of images. So you can use here image viewer, and the result will be displayed in terms of image viewer only. Some problem occurred over here, so that's why it is not working. There is some problem in embedding, but you can try this at your end. I'll be passing this to you. You just try to do this at your end. And when you actually perform the image viewer, okay, you'll be getting the result of those images which are classified into particular classes. Let me just take some quick other example. Yeah, I'll just delete this, and I'll just try to put the hierarchical clustering over here. So then I'll be putting here hierarchical clustering. Okay, if I do this like similar way, I'll be selecting this. So I have done the selection. Okay, and when I actually put here the image viewer, okay, so when I click on this, it will be showing me like this. So now it depends on what kind of thing you have selected over here. So I selected lot many things. So let me just select very few things. So I'm selecting only this thing. Only these two things I have selected. Okay, now let's see what appear in my result. Okay, so you can see here only the output I am getting as the cow and goat. Okay, so here if you see that here I'll be getting here like if I select here you can see here goat and kid, and here you can see calf and cow. So only this thing I have selected. So in the output data set I'll be getting only the animals which are having those features, okay, like cow and goat. Okay, so in this way you can actually do the image analytics also. Okay, there are different ways to do the text analytics also, but due to time constraint I could not complete it, but I will pass the similar snippets to you, and you can just try to do it by at your end. Okay, once this is given, it is very easy to do that. So you can just follow this, and you can do, and you can find out how it has to be done. So that is all from my side for today's session. Whichever things are remaining, I'll just try to pass you the information, and you can try it out.
Thank you so much, ma'am.
I'm happy to take the questions.
Yes, students and participants, would you like to ask any questions? If you have any questions, please post your questions in chat box. Okay, so please send all information on the group, all right? Everybody has enjoyed the session. So I think, are there any questions? If
unless they do it by themselves, they will not get a quiz. Because just if they're hearing what I'm saying, will not find any difficulty, but when they start doing it on and practicing it, they get not many queries.
Yes, ma'am, you will be sharing those snippets with us so that we can the text analytics as well, so that we will be able to share with the participants as well, and that will be very helpful for us. Thank you so much. So Sara Kale says she was able to do. Can this be used to classify the audio clips? A question from Meenakshi Sabde, ma'am, that can we use this particular software for classification of audio clips?
Yeah. For audio clips as such, there is no add-on available. Okay, but if you can extract the features of audio clips and that data can be provided as an input to this, then it can be done. But as such, like for image analytics, if you can see in earlier versions of Orange, this image analytics was not there. But now in recent versions, this was added. So likewise for this thing also for audio, if you can extract all the features and keep those things in ready data set, and that data set can be given as an input, then processing can be done. But as such, by directly taking the audio and doing the extracting the features and all, so Orange is not currently doing that. Or one thing you can do, you can write a Python code for extracting the features from audio, and then the rest of the part you can use from Orange, and that's the way you can process audio.
So I think, did you tested the forecast analysis of the data? So have you tested the forecast analysis?
No, actually the data I have taken just from Yahoo. But if you have some historical data on a particular case study on which you are working, okay, so you can forecast, and you can actually compare it with the actual value, okay, and you can actually validate it. So currently, whatever thing I have shown, there is no validation. But when you are actually working on the application, you need to do certain kind of validations.
Any more questions? Okay, so I think those many questions were there from the audience. So I would like to propose the formal vote of thanks now. So on behalf of HSNC University's KC College Department of Statistics, I would like to propose the formal vote of thanks to our today's speaker, Dr. Sangeeta Chowdhury ma'am, who has taken out the time from her busy schedule, and she has very nicely explained each and every feature of the software, which was barely known or which was almost unknown to all of us. It was very interesting session, and the way ma'am has taken hands-on training as well. Almost everybody has enjoyed the session, and students would like to learn more and more. So we would like to have some more sessions and collaborations with you, ma'am. Thank you so much for enlightening us in today's session. I would also like to thank our dearest principal, ma'am, who always supports our all the activities. And she couldn't attend today's session, but her blessings are always with us. She herself is a great scientist and a good academician. So my sincere gratitude to Principal Ma'am. My heartfelt thank you to our all vice principals, Mr. Smarajit Padhi, Mr. M.N. Justine, Dr. Shalini Sinha, and Dr. Tejashree Shanwar, who always help us in carrying out the activities which we plan. And they are always there to guide us on any path. My deepest thank you to Dr. Sagarika Damle, DBT Star Status Coordinator, who has taken out some time from her schedule and addressed the gathering as well. And she always motivates us to carry out good activities. And she is very helpful in collaborative work as well. And so my deepest thank you to her. My sincere thanks to my entire team of my Department of Statistics, headed by Dr. Asha Sindal ma'am, our departmental members, Dr. Mule sir, Ms. Shailaja Rane, Ms. Priyanka Chattavale, Ms. Anjali, and Mr. Suraj, who also helped me in the introduction of the speaker today. And the biggest thank you to today's audience, who have attended this workshop very sincerely and made this workshop a great success. Thank you all. Thank you, everyone, once again. Thank you so much, Sangeeta ma'am, once again. It was a very interesting session.
Yeah, thank you for the opportunity. And if you have any question, you can post me offline in the group also. That is not a problem. and I'll pass the material so that you can go through it and you can use in your educational.
We'll be happy to have for more interaction with you in future as well. Thank you so much, ma'am.
Yeah. Thank you. Have a good day.
Thank you, ma'am. Thank you, all of you. I'll post the link of feedback form. Just all the participants, please wait and